Good morning and welcome to the 30th meeting in 2015 of the Health and Sport Committee. I would ask everyone in the room to switch off all mobile phones, as they can often interfere with the sound system, and ask those present to take note that members and clerks are using tablet devices instead of their hard copies of the papers. And our first item on the agenda today is our fourth evidence session on the Alcohol Licensing Public Health and Criminal Justice Scotland Bill. And I would like to welcome from the Scottish Government, Maureen Watt, Minister for Public Health. Welcome, Minister.
Good morning.
Minister is accompanied by Peter Reid, Head of Licensing, Carole Barker-Munro, Head of the Alcohol Team, and Jennifer Stoddart, Policy Officer, Community Justice, and Douglas Forrester, Policy Manager of the Safer Communities Division. Thank you all for your attendance today. Minister, do you wish to make some opening remarks?
If I can make a brief statement.
Thank you, and then we'll proceed to questions.
Thank you very much, and I'd like to take this opportunity to make an opening statement to the Committee on the Alcohol Licensing Public Health Criminal Justice Scotland Bill. The Government is grateful for the work undertaken by the Health and Sport Committee and also the Finance Committee in seeking views from stakeholders, and we have studied these with interest. That evidence and the Finance Committee's report have been extremely valuable in helping the Government to reflect on the proposals in the Bill. I'd also like to thank Richard Simpson for bringing these issues forward. Dr. Simpson has long been an advocate on this matter, and whilst we might not always agree on the approaches we should take, we agree that the overall need for action. And I would like to put on record my recognition of the work that Dr. Simpson has done on the alcohol agenda. The government has taken time to consider the proposals in Dr. Simpson's bill because we all recognised that while generally things are moving slowly in the right direction on alcohol misuse, there's still a way to go. As committee members will be aware, having now had time to consider the memorandum issued by the Scottish Government last week, we do not support Dr. Simpson's bill progressing to stage two. Whilst we welcome and support the overarching aim of the bill to tackle alcohol misuse, there are difficulties relating to the individual measures, which I'm sure we'll discuss today. This position isn't one of complacency. We don't have a monopoly on ideas. I, along with the Cabinet Secretary for Health, Wellbeing and Sport, welcomed views from across the Parliament at the debate in June, and we'll continue to do that as work on the next phase of the Scottish Government's alcohol framework continues. But we do have a track record on taking action on this issue, and we will continue to work hard on it through the development of the next phase of the alcohol framework, not forgetting, of course, the numerous alcohol-related provisions of the recent Air Weapons and Licensing Scotland Act 2015. Convener, Scotland recently hosted the Global Alcohol Policy Alliance Conference and was chosen to do so in recognition of the action we have taken to tackle alcohol-related harm. During the conference, I had the opportunity to meet some of the world's leading experts on alcohol policy, and we'll be continuing that dialogue as we develop the next phase of the alcohol framework. So to sum up, Convener, we support the intent of this bill, but believe that the issues it raises would be better addressed via the next phase of the alcohol framework, and we will be happy to work with Dr. Simpson as we develop that work.
Thank you, Minister. Our first question this morning is from Malcolm Chisholm.
Thank you, Minister, for that opening statement. I mean, I have to say, when I read the memorandum, I was rather surprised, because I wasn't necessarily expecting you to support the bill, but I did imagine you would at least find one, two or three proposals acceptable. So it seemed very strange that you found all of them unacceptable. I mean, I have to say that to begin with, I was genuinely surprised, but I'll just take a couple, because obviously it's not up to me to go through all 10 and preempt everybody else's questions. But just taking the first one, for example, a minimum price for packages, you make the point that any restriction on promotions would be more effective if minimum unit pricing was in place. And as you know, I happen to agree with the Scottish Government on that matter. But surely something is not, because it's not going the full way in your opinion, surely you would recognise that it would still be a step in the right direction to implement that measure. So I'm not entirely clear what the objection to that is.
Well, we do agree that minimum unit pricing is the way to go. And we've seen with promotions, well, I think we want to concentrate on minimum unit pricing as the way to go. And we all know that that and the stakeholders believe that that is the best way to go. But the promotions... we know, for example, with promotions that what could happen is that the price of all the alcohol would reduce. So currently, 12 packs, the cost per unit is less than the cost of 4 or 8 packs per unit. And what would happen, it might be that the whole overall, the price of each unit would reduce. So that has been a consequence of minimum price for packages.
Well, that's an interesting argument, although you don't actually use that in your memorandum, but it seems to me that that is an unlikely consequence of what is being suggested, but I'm sure others will want to pursue that. Can I just take one other area so as not to hog the questions? But last week, or perhaps the week before, the police were very supportive of the drink banning orders. So once again, I wasn't entirely clear why you were objecting to those, that there is provision for exclusion orders in terms of someone convicted of a violent offence, and that was something in the 2005 Licensing Act, but clearly that doesn't cover all the people who may be behaving in an antisocial behaviour in licensed premises. So I just wondered what your objection to that particular one was, particularly given that the police seem to be quite very supportive of that, and I think some other witnesses, but the police certainly are the ones that are in my mind.
Yes, I noted what Police Scotland said, and they didn't provide a view on how these drink banning orders would be enforced in practice. And in the absence of further detail on how these orders would be enforced and monitored, and on the detail of the costs associated with enforcing these orders, we're not persuaded by the argument to introduce DBOs. I mean, we already have antisocial behaviours orders that provide that mechanism, and specifically ASBOs provide a mechanism to ban individuals from licensed premises.
How would the enforcement be any different from enforcement of the existing offence in terms of those that are convicted of a violent offence?
Well, as we say, as we said, we think that the antisocial behaviour orders currently provide a mechanism for the police to restrict people from licensed premises, or indeed they can be very specific as to where they're restricting a person from.
Have they been used for that purpose at all? Or?
ASBOs.
Yeah, for the purposes of excluding people from licensed premises.
I mean, the ASBOs, the records of ASBOs are recorded by local authorities. I mean, we could find out. We don't keep that information centrally, but we could find out for you if that would help.
So you're not opposed to the banning in principle, you just think that...
To me, it seems antisocial behaviour or antisocial behaviour orders and drinking ban orders work in the same way. Antisocial behaviour orders can prevent people from doing certain things, going to certain places, whatever specified in order. So antisocial behaviour orders can already ban people from licensed premises if the sheriff feels it's necessary to do so. So, but drinking banning orders seem to serve the same function.
And that can come under a community payback order or a structured deferred sentence currently.
Well, I mean, it would appear that it's not happening. I can't imagine why else the police would think this would be a useful addition. So it's obviously a gap in terms of their understanding of the situation.
Well, it is currently happening. You currently get people banned from particular licensed premises or areas of a town, for example. And I see one of your colleagues nodding.
Sorry, can I add something else? It's also drinking banning orders only appear to apply to premises which are authorised to sell alcohol on the premises. There doesn't appear to be any provision for off-licence premises and drinking banning orders, whereas antisocial behaviour orders could ban people from off-licence premises as well. So that could be a potential gap.
It may be that needs to be clarified. I think the intention that Dr. Simpson has explained to us is that they should apply to all licensed premises.
It seems in section 15.3 of the proposed bill that it's applying only to places where alcohol is for sale on the premises. So,
well, I mean, I'm sure if there was a ambiguity there, that could be clarified or amended. But I'm just trying to tease out whether you're opposed in principle or whether. Well, I don't want to be unkind, but it almost seems, and from your memorandum, it seems as if you've decided to oppose the bill and you're looking for lots of different reasons to justify that position.
Well, that's not the case. I mean, we've looked at each and every aspect of the bill, and there are, 10, 12 particular headings of the bill. And, you know, as I said in my opening statement, we're, quite happy to look at anything from any quarter in terms of taking forward our alcohol framework. But in terms of the overall bill, there may be particular parts that can fit into our alcohol framework, but in terms of the overall bill, we don't feel that it's necessary at this time.
I'm not saying that I support all parts of the bill, but I know I definitely support some parts, and some other bits I might want to amend or whatever. But it just seems to me, in principle, very hard to understand why you would be opposed to everything in the bill. That's why, ending where I began, I was genuinely shocked, because I assumed you would come to the same conclusion as I did, that at least you might not think that there were so many positive features in it, but I maybe would say, well, I agree with a large proportion of the bill, although not all of it, and perhaps I would have expected you to say, well, I agree with half of the bill and not all of it, or even I agree with a small proportion of the bill but not all of it. But it just seems a very odd position to take, that you oppose everything in the bill. I think people will find that hard to understand, people outside the Parliament.
I think it's the method on which you take forward any of the proposals in the bill, whether you start unpicking and bits that you unpick from a bill and take bits out. That's hugely complicated, and the bill is only a first stage. There's all the work behind that. I think the government would say what we believe is that it's better to take it forward in the next stage of the alcohol framework rather than divert from that, I think.
Can I just ask a supplementary to that before going?
I've got a bid for another supplementary, so if you want to speak about that, I think Bob wants to come in with a supplementary as well. Yeah.
Okay, you said you thought it would be better to take it forward under the alcohol framework. Which aspects of the bill would you take forward under the alcohol framework?
Well, we're currently working on that, and whether there's anything specific rather in the bill to take forward. For example, one of the main things from the GAPA-C conference was advertising. Now, I think there's a lot of work that can be done in that area, but of course we come up against devolved versus retained legislation there. But there are things that we can take forward from that.
Okay, I mean, given that minimum unit pricing isn't in force, is unlikely to come into force in the new near future, what are you proposing in your new alcohol framework that will actually make a difference to people's consumption of alcohol?
Well, in terms of minimum unit pricing, stakeholders agree, and certainly the GAPA conference agreed that minimum unit pricing was the best way to go.
I'm not as pessimistic as
you are. Of course, it's going through legal challenge, but most people agree that minimum unit pricing, if it can be achieved, is the best way to go. And obviously, while you know, we're not just sitting back and waiting for that to happen. Officials are working very hard to make sure that we do win that court case. So their time is taken up to a large extent, making sure that we are successful in that challenge.
So you have no new proposals as to how to tackle alcohol consumption?
Well, in terms of what happens at the moment, for example, on alcohol brief interventions, there's more work that we can do there in making sure that they are as robust and as effective that they can be. As I said, advertising is an area that we could also look at. And, you know, making sure that alcohol and drug partnerships are working to the best of their ability. There are 41 measures in the alcohol framework already, and there are aspects of that that can be looked at to make sure that we are working to the best level possible. So, you know, the restricting in in-store alcohol marketing material, for example, developing promotional activity codes of practice. There's lots in the framework which we can take forward.
So it seems that there are no new proposals. Can I maybe then turn to one?
Can we just supplement in some of the, okay. And then I'll get you back in immediately with a Bob?
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I will restrict myself to the supplementary. What was the substantive question, which was in relation to drinking banning orders, I understand, from Mr. Chisholm, and we are seeking to scrutinise this bill. I want some clarity around this area. The government seems to be suggesting that any powers that would be extended via drinking banning orders are already covered in relation to antisocial behaviour legislation. I think that was the substantive point the government was making. Can I just clarify that is the government position?
Yes.
Right, so that is the government position. The question was also asked, and I found it a very interesting question in relation to whether or not ASBOs were currently used for that purpose. And I'll be asking the same question to Dr. Simpson when he's got the opportunity, because that's the kind of thing I'd expect the person proposing this bill to already have analysed. But I'll have the opportunity to ask that question later. Has the Scottish Government got any information whether ASBOs, any systematic information whether ASBOs have or haven't been used for that purpose?
We were talking about that earlier, Jennifer. Do you want to come in on that?
And social behaviour, we don't keep information central, and it's information is held by local authorities. I mean, antisocial behaviour orders can be used to ban people from licensed premises if it's an alcohol-related offence. If the sheriff deems that necessary, so the power is there to do so.
Right. It strikes me that perhaps one of the things that should happen is that the relevant bodies are reminded that they already have that power. But given the fact that no information is held, let me put one final point to the witnesses this morning. Now, if that power already exists and it's being used, it would seem to me that there's no need to duplicate power that already exists. If that power exists and it's not been used, then surely that's because there's a lack of information that the power exists, or the relevant bodies have decided it's not a desirable power to use particularly often. Do the witnesses believe that drinking banning orders extends in any way the tools that are in the box to deal with antisocial behaviour and problem drinking in our communities?
That's kind of a justice issue rather than a public health issue. So,
I think one of the difficulties that we had around the proposal was a lack of detail on how they would be enforced and what the associated cost might be to that, and also a lack of evidence in England and Wales. When they had drinking banning orders, they haven't done an evaluation at this stage, so it was difficult to see how they could be applied in Scotland in the absence of that.
Okay, no, I appreciate that. So I'm going to leave it here, but I appreciate that's a judicial question, but a justice question, but it's the kind of question my constituents would probably want me to ask, which is why I did so. But
yeah, I think that's true. And we got good evidence last week, Minister, from Police Scotland, who said that this would be a useful tool in the box. And you know, so we have got our answer on that.
I th- Can I just say, convener, that I think drink banning orders haven't been taken forward in England and Wales, and the evidence and evaluation isn't there.
There are, we might come to it later, there are other measures that have been taken forward that have proved very successful. That again, in your response, you haven't been able to support, despite successful application down south. Not in banning orders, but other measures, I said, within that have been rejected, proved successful down south. So we can't, if we apply that principle, we would be supporting some of those measures here. But we have good evidence from Police Scotland. Again, I say, a useful tool in the box. Rhoda?
Can I maybe turn to one of the measures I think that is successful down south, the bottle marking? Again, an element of the bill that was welcomed by Police Scotland. Can I ask why you've rejected this?
Bottle marking. We don't support the proposal at this time. We believe that it would impose considerable burdens on the trade and would not provide evidence of any offence that has been committed. So the police might find a bottle that's marked and it comes from a particular store, but it can't tell who has bought that particular bottle. And you heard in the call for evidence that one national retailer said that it would cost, I think, £3.3 million, they quoted, to comply with mandatory bottle marking. So we believe that the widespread use of bottle marking would be disproportionate, and we don't believe that, we remain to be convinced that we need legislation in this area.
Okay. Bottle marking is on request by the police. Do you believe then, is the natural progression from what you're saying, is that the police would abuse that power?
No, I didn't say that the police would abuse that power at all. I mean, we have a number of measures in place already to discourage underage drinking. For example, there's the Challenge 25 scheme, and we know that it's an offence to proxy purchase, and in the recent Air Weapons and Licensing Scotland Bill, it will be an offence to supply alcohol to someone underage in a public place. So there are measures in place already to help the police to do that.
Given this is something that the police have said would be helpful, given it's something that has been trialled elsewhere in the UK and has been very successful, and given your answer to the previous question about getting results from measures in the bill, this is one that has proven that it would work. I mean, I can't really understand, given that the police want it, it's proven, why you are against it, and given that the sums of money are obviously at maximum use, and you yourself believe the police wouldn't misuse this power, therefore it wouldn't have that financial impact.
Well, I think you also had evidence from Alcohol Focus Scotland, who raised concerns about this proposal, and we know already that from SALSA's findings that only 8% of 15-year-olds reported buying alcohol from a shop. I think we all know that that youngsters get their alcohol not from shops but from family and friends, and we don't believe that bottle marking, we think that it's disproportionate, would be a disproportionate cost to what the results might be.
And I mean, we've all seen and we all know that young people send older people into the off-licence or whatever to buy their alcohol. A prudent owner or worker in an off-licence will be aware of what's going on outside their door and take measures to stop it. And I've seen that happen myself, where someone's been refused alcohol because the off-licence owner knows that they are going to pass it on to somebody outside. Surely bottle marking is even a bigger deterrent, because the off-licence owner would be even more stringent in the measures they would take to make sure it didn't fall into the wrong hands.
Yes, but you know, I think there are measures in place already for proxy purchasing to make that an offence, and the police already use that. But it was suggested that were there to be a condition on licensing, meeting the requirement physically to check every can or bottle would be extremely onerous task on the licensing standards officers. So what we're saying is that we think it's the cost is disproportionate to the results that may come from this.
But this is not every can and bottle, this is on request of the police.
Yeah, yes, and I know that you went to on a fact-finding visit to Newcastle to find out more about their alcohol container marking schemes. The primary reason for bottle marking is seen as an intelligence gathering measure rather than a direct means to tackle an alcohol-related disorder.
It's also a deterrent.
It could be.
Yeah, the Newton, you know, we take the opportunity to put a fact-finding visit information on record, Minister, and we spoke to police, health officials and the local authority enforcement officers as well. And what we did find, or what they claimed, was a targeted approach to this gave the police very much lots of intelligence in terms of to eliminate off licences so who weren't selling to younger people or to others who were selling on. They claimed that it helped those who worked on off licences to resist pressure and peer pressure from young people that were coming in requesting alcohol, because there are signs and marking, and it's a, you know, a very focused idea. Mr. Reid is looking at me quizzically.
No,
it was just I thought just a pain that passed, was it? But you know, they claim lots of success at this. Have any of the officials who work in this area examined the initiatives that are being implemented, including minimum pricing in bars and city centres in Newcastle, price marking, targeting of strong drinks and particular drinks geographically? Is anyone who have been involved in the framework and all the work that's been done to the Scottish Government examined any of the results and initiatives that have been in place in Newcastle over the last 4 or 5 years?
In relation to the bottle marking, I've been in post and licensing for 3-4 years now. I'm not aware of any evidence that's crossed my desk in relation to bottle marking. Yep. I note also that the Spice report struggled to find any reports on any bottle marking initiatives in Scotland, although it noted that they had been undertaken. Yes. I speak to stakeholders in relation to alcohol licensing all the time. Bottle marking is certainly something that I've discussed informally with licensing standards officers, trade representatives and others from time to time. The general impression I have got in relation to bottle marking is that there have been at times specific initiatives that have worked quite well. However, those have been short, time-limited, voluntary initiatives. Mm. On that basis, talking about a measure that would potentially, you know, I think one of the stakeholders mentioned a cost of $3.3 million. It relates to, you know, in my head, I'm envisaging, you know, a place like Asda with aisle upon aisle of product. Looking at the last Solicitor study from 2013. Young people drink pretty much the same as adults drink. They drink a wide variety of products.
Do you live near an off-licence in your community?
Similar to everyone. There's an Asda not far away, and there's premises.
An off-licence in some hard-pressed communities who suffer on a regular basis. Youths gathering, underage drinks, all the consequences of that, whether it's setting fires behind. It's that targeting that the police and the authorities in Newcastle pursue. I was surprised, and I think many of our members are surprised, about the initiatives that Newcastle have been able to implement over the last 4 or 5 years. I'm just surprised that people who are here with the Minister today have got no knowledge of that. nor did we. We hadn't those papers and facts and figures. We had to go to Newcastle. And we found that Newcastle have implemented minimum pricing in bars in Newcastle. We found that they have successful marking programmes in Newcastle. We have late-night levies that are used to divert from alcohol and fund alcohol diversion projects. It's a very interesting place where they have been pursuing these policies for the last 4 or 5 years. Maybe some of you should get down there, is my message to you.
Fair enough.
Thanks. I've got Richard Lyle. Yes,
thank
Dennis.
You. Thank you. You know, I have to say that maybe Newcastle's got problems that sometimes we don't have, and crime is at an all-time low in Scotland. But can I come on to the concerns that I've got? And maybe the government has concerns about this bill. I also have concerns about the bill, and I'm sure other members may have concerns about the bill. Can I contain my comments in regard to container marking and off-sales? Now, with the greatest respect to Dr. Simpson, I, as already have said, worked as a grocer for 14 years, so know the problems within a shop. It's been suggested by the Scottish Grocers Association that this will put a very substantial cost onto grocers, depending on where, and even with the point of if there was a container marking and we went to Asda, I'm sure it would be thousands upon thousands upon thousands of cans that would need to be, and bottles that would need to be marked. Have you ever walked up the aisles in Asda? How much, you know, like two aisles containing drinks? So if you wanted to, if they had a particular problem outside Asda in any town, they would have to mark quite a lot of stuff. And basically, that's a concern I've got. And it's actually 3.7 million, it's not 3.3 million. As the estimated cost per annum to shops. But can I ask the Minister, Dr. Simpson suggested within in a response to some of the comments that licensing fees have not been increased since 2007, and that even keeping the same in real terms would mean a 23% increase. Would she accept that grocers should be faced with a 23% increase in the licensing fee across the whole of Scotland to pay for this?
Well, I think that's a local issue for licensing boards themselves, but clearly, you know, if you were faced with a 23% increase in one go, that would be a severe dent to the businesses and the profitability of the business. But in terms of that, as I say, that is up to the local licensing authority, as I understand it.
The Scottish Government did undertake a review of licensing fees a short while ago. Unfortunately, we weren't able to obtain sufficient evidence from local authorities to really do as much as we would like to in relation to that. That's why the recent Air Weapons and Licensing Scotland Bill included a provision that would will require licensing boards to report on their income and expenditure. This will enable us to gather the evidence on local authorities' costs in relation to licensing to allow us to review the fees properly, which we intend to do in due course. That would allow us to look at the structure of the fees and the maximum fees that could be charged, but the intention with the licensing regime is always that the licensing regime fees are set to recover the costs of the local authorities, and the local authorities do not make a profit on the licensing fees.
Now, we have within the current situation that the police could, if they wish to check on, you know, had people were reporting concerns, and the convener said about if there were concerns outside your local licensing off sales, the police can go in and do test purchases through getting under, you know, specific youth to go in. And is that used quite a lot in Scotland?
It's within the legislation that the police can use it, and they run exercises from time to time. Certainly, I'm on a community council, and I'm aware that test purchasing has been carried out locally.
Right. Minister, you made a comment during your statement about the bottle marking and you know the stickers that they wanted to put on. in a shop. And it was also said by the police and also by the Scottish Federation, Grocers Federation, in evidence that where stickers could be used doesn't necessarily mean that it was purchased by a youth, because, and I'll explain this, someone could go into an adult, their parents could get and buy a couple of cans of beer, take them home, put them in the fridge, and unfortunately their sibling could take the can of beer out of the fridge and go down the park or whatever. That doesn't necessarily prove that the shop sold the drink to the child, and that can may have sat in the fridge for the last couple of months, who knows?
Yes, you're absolutely right. You've answered your own question. We know that most youngsters get their drink from family and friends, and you know, where there is an issue, as you highlighted, convener, of people outside and off licence, then there is the Scottish Government's working with the industry partnership on the proxy campaign. For example, in North Lanarkshire, Community Safety Partnership have undertaken a test purchase pilot scheme recently in Motherwell and Wishaw, and that has resulted in a reduction in crime and antisocial behaviour. It resulted in 84 offences being detected over a four-month period. So there are initiatives throughout the country. That's just one example of where there is an issue of antisocial behaviour that the police, together with the industry, work together.
Yeah. I should say that the police in Newcastle work very closely with the industry. That's why they've made a lot of progress there. But just like the text purchases in Lanarkshire, as you mentioned, that's not a continuous scheme. It will be used appropriately, targeted, and it will be an initiative that will last 3 months or 6 months, and then we'll move on to another area. It's not in place all of the time, is it?
Well, it can be if the
if
the police recognise that there's an ongoing problem, then they can do that. But obviously lessons are learned and behaviour can be changed as a result of that. So you don't need to continue it.
No, I agree. But I was referring back to the earlier remarks that, you know, any of these initiatives are to be used to the maximum. Every can in Asda is to be marked up, and these powers are to be used continuously. That's not the way these powers, in any shape or circumstance, would be used, or existing powers. They're used to target particular instances, geographical positions, and where there's a problem, and whether the police, in many cases, request it. Is that not the case?
Yes, it is where the police, working with the local industry, both partners see that there's a problem and they work to resolve it. And normally you see an ongoing benefit from that, even although, you know, the resources may not be continued to be put in at that particular level.
Yeah. Dennis.
Convener, I hadn't finished my question.
You had three questions.
Well, other people had four and five. can I just ask one more question?
If you proceed with it quickly, I've got a couple of people waiting.
In regards to the caffeine, alcohol drinks containing caffeine. Well, it's a question, in case I don't get back in. Dr. Simpson pointed towards research that suggested 5,000 crimes in Strathclyde had been committed by people drinking a certain type of caffeine tonic wine. We are suggesting that a ban on this could reduce this figure. Do you agree with that?
We don't feel that targeting one particular drink is effective. A lot has been said about one particular drink, but it is the amount that people drink rather than the type of drink that is the problem here. I mean, you can get the same effect by mixing other drinks as you can with the particular drink that you might be referring to. So we don't believe that targeting particular drinks is necessary.
Thank you, Kadina.
Sorry to keep you waiting, Dennis.
Thank you, Kadina. And good morning, Minister. I just wonder if I could go back to the marking and the proxy purchasing just for a second. Minister, do you believe that we have sufficient current legislation in place at the moment, along with the voluntary schemes? I think you've indicated we have, but I just want to get it very clear in my own head that the raft of legislation that's available to us at the moment actually enables us to use that specific legislation and the voluntary schemes within specific target areas where you believe, or where it is believed, that there are problems. Do you believe that the legislation and voluntary schemes is currently at a place that it could be invoked if required?
I'm in no doubt that we could obviously do more, but I think that the legislation that is in place currently has shown to be effective where it is used in partnership between the police, the local authority, licensing, and the industry themselves. So, the figures from the North Lanarkshire initiative are really quite startling. In terms of the reduction in crime and antisocial behaviour that they saw. So it is up to where there is a problem identified. I do believe that what we have in place at the moment is does go a long way to help industry and communities tackle the problem.
Do you also believe then that the intelligence that is there is shared widely enough, say across the specific, say, health board areas and with Police Scotland in general, to take that forward and to use perhaps, you know, good exemplars of practice in tackling these problems? Do you think that information is shared widely enough, or do you think it is just sort of within the sort of health board or local authority area that they're keeping it to themselves and not sharing it?
I think
he's slightly flippant, Minister, of course.
I think the industry themselves share the information quite widely. The Scottish Government Industry Alcohol Partnership has done a great deal of work in this area, and the industry itself is very keen to help in local areas where the police may identify a problem. And I think the industry share it. I'm not sure if licensing boards share it, and obviously the police will share it.
So do you believe that the government has a role to try and to take that forward? Because we're really looking at the fact of raising that awareness, because awareness in itself doesn't resolve a problem. You need other measures there. But raising awareness around the issues and in certain specific areas would certainly help. In relation to this, do you not believe that because there's a raft of different legislation around, that perhaps consolidation of legislation around licensing and the sale of alcohol would be beneficial to the trade?
I think in lots of areas, people believe that there should be consolidation of legislation, and we are very keen that legislation isn't unduly burdensome, and that's why the recent Air Weapons and Licensing Scotland Act focused on addressing areas within existing legislation that we felt could be operating in a better way than it currently does, rather than having major revisions. We are keen and committed to fully implementing the provisions that have already been passed by the Scottish Parliament and ensuring that the proper supporting secondary legislation is updated where necessary.
Do you think it's something that government would look at in terms of, because I think one of the problems that seems to exist is there's a deal of confusion as to which legislation pathway people are needing to go down. And do you not think that consolidation of the legislation around this may help? And indeed, it would probably help clarify what is actually legislative process and what is voluntary. And I think sometimes the two are confused in people's minds, and perhaps within taking forward enforcement sometimes there may be some degree of confusion. Do you think there is a place, and do you think that it's something that government could or may look at, given from the evidence that we've heard around Dr. Simpson's bill?
I think that's for political parties and Scottish ministers to determine in future legislative work and in future bills, and taking into account the full range of priorities that they have. But I take on board what you say and other members have said about the fact of making sure that best practice is circulated as widely as possible, and that the secondary legislation that is enacted is as clear and concise as possible.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thanks, Dennis. Bob Dorris.
Thank you very much. It's been interesting because it's such a varied bill. It's quite difficult to scrutinise systematically throughout it all. We seem to have scrutinised relatively well 0.6 and 0.8 in relation to restrictions in alcohol advertising and drinking banning orders, and the government position seems to be there was a duplication and overlap in much of these powers. Seem to exist. I had a brief supplementary at point 4 before I go into my substantive question, which is in relation to container marking and off sales. One of my concerns in relation to that was it was a police-led intervention on a licensing decision. So my understanding is where the police insist on the marking provisions, the licensing committee should agree to it. And if they don't agree to it, they must write with detailed reasons back to the police as to why they've not acquiesced to that. So my concern was, I'm not sure, I have to say, whether or not the bottle marking scheme on a statutory basis works, because the convener gave very strong evidence that it works on a voluntary and partnership basis, and I think that was quite compelling on a voluntary focused partnership basis. But I do have some concerns about police-led licensing decisions, because of course the police have got very strong views on things, but the whole point is the licensing committee looks at a broader range of issues and has a broader perspective out with specifically what the police may have. So I'm just wondering if there's any views in relation to police-led intervention in relation to that aspect of licensing.
I'll hand over to Peter.
It's an interesting point you raise. The way that the provision is drafted is unusual, and it doesn't call to my mind anything. Another provision elsewhere in the Act that would sit alongside it. In effect, the police have an ability to ask for the bottle marking to be imposed. It's something that presumably the police would incur no costs in asking, and would it's up to them to the extent that they would police it. Then it would be for the board to determine whether they agreed with this and explain why not if they didn't agree. Similarly, the board would have relatively modest costs in relation to it. The costs would be passed on to the traders themselves, and it would be that, you know, they would have relatively little ability to dispute or disagree or raise concerns about it. So I can see that for the police that this seems reasonable, but the degree of proportionality and testing in the process, it's not obvious to me where in that process there would be the testing of the evidence and the proportionality of it, and whether it was an appropriate thing to do, how long it should apply for, what products it should apply for.
I can imagine why the police might be quite keen, because I understand that the provisions also allows them to determine what form the marking would take as well. So it gets into an area where I wouldn't have thought necessarily the police were experts. And of course, in relation to that, they wouldn't necessarily be part of the enforcement regime. That would be a local authority level. So I can see why the police would be interested in this. But as I say, that was my concern in relation to whether who should lead on that strategy, the police or the licence committee, based on all the stakeholders involved. Now, so that was point 8, point 6 I've referred to, and point 4 I had a little supplementary on. And I'm just trying to name check them, because I want to make sure the committee gets through the range of measures in the bill to get the government's considered opinion. Point 10, I think, is reasonable to say was one of the most contentious parts of the bill. I think I'm probably on safe ground in saying I can't really recall anyone being supportive of it, other than maybe the member in charge, and that was a notification of offender's GP from the courts when an individual is guilty or convicted of an offence where alcohol was a contributing factor. There was significant concerns raised. I won't repeat those again for brevity, not something I'm used to doing is brevity at this committee. I'm just wondering if the Minister could perhaps flesh out what your concerns would be in relation to GPs being drawn into what might be a, same as a kind of judicial sphere, and whether that would undermine trust in the GP-patient relationship?
Yes, I think on consultation it wasn't considered an issue that should be taken forward in calls for evidence at the initial proposal, and it was quite surprising to see it in the bill. And again, the BMA and others had significant concerns about the proposal, mainly about patient GP confidentiality and their evidence. I think that you had in previous weeks was quite clear that GPs will normally know where a patient has an alcohol problem and will, through alcohol brief interventions and other methods, make sure that if the patient is willing, that something is done about it. But the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service also highlighted the implications and the practical problems about ensuring, for example, that the correct GP was identified and notified. And I think they estimated the cost about £150,000 per annum and an additional IT cost of around £10 million. But we always know how IT costs are never accurate. Cost. Yeah, 10,000. Is that what I said?
Yeah, 10,000.
Yeah. So I think there was widespread opposition from other respondents, including the GMC, Alcohol Focus Scotland, and others.
I suppose that's all on the record. I was kind of maybe keen to get ministers put on the record what your thoughts. I'll just say one final aspect on it, and then I'll let my colleagues in. There are other aspects of the bill I'd like to come back in if time permits, convener, but one of the concerns that struck myself was the fact that whilst there would be no duty for the GP to act on the information received, they may feel in relation to their professional code of ethics, and I apologize, the terminology is escaping me at the moment, that they may feel they've got an ethical duty in terms of their code of practice to act on this. And it's been raised with myself that those who have issues in relation to alcohol have to be ready, willing and able to receive the support, and to feel obliged, as some GPs have told me they might do, to act at a stage where someone has been through a criminal process may not actually have the desired outcome in relation to reaching out to those most in need of support for alcohol brief interventions, for example. So that's a concern I would have, and of course Dr. Simpson maybe will tell you some of those fears when he gives evidence later. I'm just wondering if you share those concerns.
Yes, I think I do share the concerns. I mean, if someone has an alcohol problem and it's meant that they've come up against the law, you can't really determine what their priorities are at that particular time, you know, and perhaps going to the GP is not top of their list, or in fact going to an alcohol and drug partnership. So people need to be wanting to do that at a particular time, and the GP services or the alcohol and drug partnerships need to be there, willing and able to help at that particular time.
Okay, thank you, Minister, and thank you, Convener. I may come back in later if time permits, because there's still aspects of the bill we've not
got opinions good, from. Good. Just for the record, I've came across some of the question of price and costs of the marking scheme, and I'm just looking at a report from Newcastle. Bob Doris was correct, and it's a voluntary scheme. It's targeted. Looks for intelligence and dealing with antisocial behaviour and identifying issues and problem solving. But the community safety officer outlined the cost as 12 pence per sticker, and the average intervention was £240 to deal with an error, and that was poster stickers, etc., etc. So just a bit proportionate between the figures, but that's what it costs them. To do those sort of initiatives and publicity in and around, you know, targeted drinks, targeted areas, and whatever, dealing with a problem.
Pounds to the police or £240.
£240 for the stickers and the other publicity and information that goes around that area, is what we're told. The other issue, just following on from the brief interventions and alcohol awareness training, as an alternative to fixed penalty fines, you know, becoming a you know, an ambassador for Newcastle here, but they said to the committee members who attended, it was an absolute no-brainer. It's self-financing, and that was the option. When you're involved in an alcohol-related incident in the city centre of Newcastle on a Saturday night, you have an option of reducing your fine from around £90 to £45. And the basis attending a morning training session, which goes through the alcohol issues and alcohol awareness, and the claim, and that they've run it for quite a while now, the claim that there's a higher rate of reoffending from those who do not attend the alcohol awareness training, and they claim it's self-financing. Do you not feel that something like that would be an additional useful method to all of the other interventions that the Scottish Government do support at this time? And you know, that's one of these areas that you would have thought we would have gained some consensus around. It seems that we've got something here that's useful as a brief intervention, it's cost effective, it's delivering results, and we're not supporting it. You know, I suppose why wouldn't we if it would be a useful addition to what we already do?
I think, Convener, that we will be looking further at the issue of increasing access for those who need it to alcohol awareness, and that through the development of the next stage of the alcohol framework. I think it's important to stress the differences in approach between alcohol awareness training, which is compulsory, and much more directive, whereas ABIs are optional and motivational. Under community payback orders, for example, where people have been identified through the courts as being alcohol dependent, part of their community payback order will be to get treatment for their alcohol dependency. And under, as I understand it, supervision under a CPO may also require alcohol treatment. But Jennifer, you can perhaps explain this better.
I think, as is raised in the policy memorandum, for an alcohol treatment requirement under a community payback order, the individual does need to have a diagnosed dependency. However, there is also a supervision requirement within a CPO, which is a requirement that's used second most often within CPOs, and under that, if someone has an issue with alcohol, they can be directed to access alcohol support. And from feedback from local authorities, from criminal justice social work, that tends to be where people on conviction, where alcohol is thought to be an issue around their offending, where they can access that support.
Yeah. But Mira, do you not accept that there's a good principle in this? It's about earlier intervention. The people who will develop an alcohol problem are likely to present themselves in the justice system earlier on, present themselves in the employment situation, domestic, you know, these sort of things that are dealt with more and more now in the early stages with, a ticket or a court appearance in that intervention. And of course, with that intervention, you're not compelled to go along to that four-hour session. You can defer. There is an incentive, but you're not compelled to go along, and many don't. And many of those who don't go along to that training session, that alcohol awareness session, go on to get into trouble through alcohol at a later stage. A higher proportion of them, than, you know. So, I'm struggling to see why initiatives such as this would be dismissed out of hand by the Minister of the Scottish Government. Why would we dismiss such a sensible proposal out of hand that's working and it's cost effective? It's a no-brainer, as we've been told.
Because we've got alternatives that are working here in Scotland. I mean, that's why we've rolled out ABIs, not just through GPs, but also in the justice setting. You know, certainly Newcastle have chosen to go down a different route from us, but I think our alcohol brief interventions are working in Scotland.
Yeah, but the thing is, what's proposed in the bill is not contradictory to what you're already doing. It's additional to what you're already doing. I mean, the evidence, it was evidence from Newcastle, because the percentage of those who reoffended who hadn't taken up the option was higher than those who had taken up the option. So the key thing is, it's an option. But again, I'm interested in the memorandum and the reasons given and what you're saying today, because I'm still mystified by this explanation you have in the memorandum for not pursuing it, which is different from what you said today, because this proposal would create an obligation on Scottish ministers to make future legislation. And I'm really struggling with that, because this is the legislation that permits this. So I don't see, this is kind of presented as the main objection to it in your memorandum, is it creates an obligation on ministers to create future legislation. I'm really struggling with that, which is why my suspicion is you're just looking for all sorts of reasons, which some of which may be valid, but I don't see how that's a valid objection to it. If you could explain that, it would be helpful.
Okay, Carol's going to explain.
I think the memorandum's intent is to say that what we have coming down the track is a refresh of the alcohol framework. The existing alcohol framework is very well regarded. It benchmarks very well against the World Health Organization. It's got a lot of good stuff in it. What we're at the early stages of doing is examining what's worked in relation to that framework. And we've got a report coming out in March, which is the MESAS evaluation report, which will look at what's worked and then start pulling together lots of fresh ideas and new things that we can put into the framework. So we're not saying that all ideas are off the table. We're just saying that there's a process there that we've just started to look at the new framework, against which we can test some more of the ideas. I'd be interested in the evaluation of the report from Alcohol Awareness Training from Newcastle. And from that, we can pull together a framework which prioritises the measures and lifts those that need legislation into legislation, allows those which can be taken forward voluntarily to be taken forward voluntarily. So I wouldn't like to suggest that we're ruling out any other measures that aren't ours, because that's not the case. It's just a point towards a process which is underway, that we've started engagement with the public health NGOs on, that we'd like to engage with the committee on in future. But we're at the early stages of that. So for us, this legislation possibly preempts some of the things that might come out of the alcohol framework. And what we want to do is to take a broader look across the piece about what might work. But certainly there's things that we've heard of in the evidence, say particularly the evidence from Newcastle, that I would be interested in hearing. We're always keen to try and find out how we can educate people more around alcohol awareness. ABIs is part of that. Fixed penalty notices could be an option, but just not at this time, because the framework's not quite ready yet.
Well, that's more open-minded, so I welcome that. Thank you.
Yeah, but I mean, surely we knew that when we voted for the to start this process. I mean, because I say, you know, if that was the government's view when the Parliament took a decision to examine this, but it would have saved this committee a heck of a lot of time and evidence if we had that view at the point and said, well, don't bring this bill. We're not going to support it. You know, we're not going to support the scrutiny of this bill. And we could have been saying, you know, let's examine this. Let's take this on board. We're working on a framework. Let's involve that in the framework. But they saved this committee a haircut of a lot of time and taking evidence to get to this stage, where we're not going to vote the general principles in the bill on the basis that we might take a lot of these things on, but we believe it's better to take them forward in the new alcohol framework, which is a decent argument. But would have saved us a bit of time if we'd have known that earlier, and we've spent weeks in a very busy committee examining this on the basis that we may be taking it forward.
Well, we can't stop a member taking forward a private member's bill, and also the Cabinet Secretary made that very clear in the debate that we would be taking forward different strategies in the refresh of the alcohol framework. Mm.
Nanette.
Back to the bill. It is to do with the community involvement in licensing decisions. And I notice that the government is committed to review regulations which contain license notification requirements. And I just wondered, does the government actually have concerns about the impact of inactive community councils in the licensing consultation process, which are mainly in deprived areas? And are there any plans to address this?
In terms of community councils, the Scottish Government does assist community councils that are around 1,200 active community councils from, I think, a potential of 1,369. And under the Local Government Scotland Act 1973, local authorities have statutory oversight over community councils. And we do help them in a number of ways to be active in their areas through community council websites, community council knowledge hub, and the Scottish Government hosts a biannual networking events for community councils. So there is a lot of support for community councils, and I think that was during the debate that we had in June on the next stage of the alcohol framework, the Cabinet Secretary announced that Alcohol Focus would have a dedicated worker to help community councils in relation to licensing applications. And I know in Glasgow there's a lady who's very active in supporting communities in relation to licensing applications. So that work is being taken forward.
So you are getting through to some of the more deprived areas, for instance, in Glasgow. Okay. The other thing was extending the views on extending the time periods involved in displaying notices of licensing applications and variations, and also extending the distances within which neighbours of a premises are notified of licensing applications. Are you looking at reviewing that as well?
Yes, in terms of the extending the time periods, we do intend to engage with the relevant stakeholders and consult prior to updating the Licensing Procedure Scotland Regulations 2007. I think it should be noted that few objections are put in within the time period, but of course objections to licensed premises, as you know, can go on at any time if people have neighbours have concern about licensed premises, they can object at any time that they want. We can help communities, people are in place to are going to be put in place to help communities frame a case against particular premises or over provision of premises, and we're committed to making sure that happens and it works effectively and encouraging effective community involvement in licensing decisions.
Okay, and what about extending the distance for neighbour notification? I mean, we did have witnesses say that in a particularly built up area that could cause a significant amount of work notifying people, you know, and say tenanted properties very close together. Have you any views on that? Because the bill does propose extending that distance.
That is the sort of issue that we'd test out prior to laying updated secondary legislation. Our intention is that people can engage effectively and make representations, and you know that's what we'll try and capture when we consult and engage and see how we can update the secondary legislation to make sure that that works effectively. We're open-minded on the issue. We want to see something that will work and is proportionate.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks, Nanette. Bob, Doris.
Thank you very much, Convener. I just wanted maybe to look again, let's get the right section again on the bill that we're looking at. So Section 9, Alcohol Awareness Training as an Alternative Fixed Penalty Fines. I'm just wondering if we're actually quite close as a committee, as the member in charge of the bill in the Scottish Government, we're actually all very close to the same thing. So reading my notes says that there has been a pilot in Fife. Don't think that required legislation. So it can be done without legislation. I'm sure the Scottish Government would want to look in detail in relation to how that pilot worked. And if it was successful, they would want to look at availability of such provisions across Scotland. Whether it requires legislation or not, I'm not so sure, given the fact that a pilot has actually been run. So I'm just wondering if this is one of these things where actually we're very close to agreeing with each other. Whether it needs legislation or not is another matter, of course. So I'd appreciate the Minister's thoughts on that. And is that something that you'd give specific consideration to in any refreshed framework in relation to alcohol?
Do you want to take that, Carole?
I think one of the key things that we'll be looking for in terms of the refresh framework is around how do we get alcohol awareness education in its broadest sense out to people. Now, people who come through the criminal justice system is obviously one area. I think we are open-minded. We would want to be clear whether something wants legislation or not. We would want things to be properly costed so that we could understand exactly how much things were going to cost, what training should be provided, and how effective it was. As I said, we're at the early stages of that with the framework. On a personal level, I'm not convinced that this needs legislation. The fact that the pilot went forward without legislation is encouraging. It means that should ministers choose and resources are available and local partners are willing, that potentially it could be something that could be taken forward. But to tie it at the moment in legislation when it's not costed and it's not clear who would be provided the training seems just a little premature in terms of the rollout of the next phase of the framework.
You see, that becomes a compelling narrative from what I can see. The fact that if there was a pilot, it didn't require legislation, it would make sense for the government to take consideration of that pilot in any refreshed framework. And I think in other matters unrelated to this bill, all members from all parties have said there's no point in giving a right or giving a direction of travel if you can't then resource the framework behind that. So you can, in theory, have an alternative to a fine in one part of the country, in theory. But then if the educational support and classes aren't there, then it becomes meaningless. You can't then dispose of that. So I get that narrative. But the key thing was, I think that was quite helpful to put on the record, that there's an open-mindedness in relation to that. But more importantly for me, it doesn't necessarily require legislation, given the fact that we're actually scrutinising legislation here this morning. Can I turn to point one of the bill now in relation to minimum price for packages containing more than one alcoholic product? Now, remember the legislation that we passed here a few years ago in relation to minimum pricing. I'm minded it obviously wasn't just minimum pricing, it was discount sales and the restrictions in relation to those. And it would appear as if maybe it's just slightly incomplete in relation to that, to those discount bans. And this would appear to complete that. I'm just wondering if the Scottish Government has got any data in relation to whether or not they believe that addressing this seeming loophole would have an impact in relation to further reducing alcohol overconsumption. I'd be quite interested to know if there's evidence that this particular loophole would do that, because I know when the substantive discount ban came into place, there was quite a dramatic fall in relation to the purchase of 3-for-2s and that kind of things in relation to alcohol, and consumption in relation to that went down. So I'm just wondering whether or not the government thinks this would be a substantive addition to that, or whether it's a minor amendment, or just what. I know there's a written reply, but it's quite good to get some of that on the record, I think.
The legislation that was drafted initially was done so because the drafting was used in order to legislate within our devolved competence. That is why the legislation is as it is currently drafted.
Okay. I suppose, does it remain out with their competence? I mean, I suppose that's a separate one. That becomes a do we have the power or not argument. I feel like in a linear yes, no. I'm more interested in whether or not acting on it would make a substantive difference or not, I suppose, is the question I'm asking.
Okay, Carole, you've got some evidence on that.
We Sheffield University conducted an assessment of which predicted savings from a whole range of price promotions, and the banning 3 for 2s that you already put through was part of that. You're right, realised was associated with a 2.6 reduction, which is significant. It's not possible from that report to analyse what Dr Simpson's measure would precisely do. In order to realise the full savings that Sheffield predicted, you would need to ban all price promotions, and we're clear that that wouldn't be legal. So what we're saying is that we don't, at the moment, have the evidence to know exactly what this amendment would do. It doesn't feel to us that it would be a proportionate one. We would rather focus on minimum unit pricing in terms of our efforts, but that's the position at the moment.
Okay, so the government position is the data is unclear in relation to what impact this would have. Thank you.
Okay. A couple of areas, just for the record, Minister, that we've not covered in this. The alcohol education policy statements, and Dr Simpson seems to be of the view that the proposal encouraging, the proposal encouraging more parliamentary scrutiny of the Scottish Government's alcohol strategy more broadly, and the government is arguing that that would be disproportionate. How do we get to the stage where, or does the Scottish Government welcome more scrutiny of the alcohol strategy more generally? Because I think we've exposed a couple of things here this morning in terms of we're able to cite the initiative in Lanarkshire or Newcastle here or there, and it's a bit patchy. How do we get the widest understanding about what's going on in the strategy that is being effective and it can be rolled out? And does the Scottish Government, would the Scottish Government not welcome more scrutiny in and around the alcohol strategy more generally?
Yes, Convener, we are committed, as you know, to evaluating and monitoring the impact of our policies, and that's why we've established the Monitoring and Evaluating Scotland's Alcohol Strategy, the MESAS programme of evaluation, which is carried out by NHS Scotland, and this evaluates the strategy as a whole and the work that is publicly available. We believe that the proposal on alcohol policy statements would increase bureaucracy, and it wouldn't really make a meaningful contribution towards reducing alcohol-related harm. I mean, we are always, as you know, at your disposal to come and give evidence to committee on our strategies, and we will continue to work with all the stakeholders and yourselves. There's a plethora of information. There are campaigns that are carried out on an annual and biennial basis, and these are evaluated. We've had the debates on the strategy in Parliament, and as I say, we're always open to your scrutiny.
Yeah. If time would allow, it would be great to do all of these and provide that scrutiny that we would like to carry out. You mentioned earlier, and Colin hasn't come in this morning, but there's been a lot of interest in around, a lot of discussion about the restrictions on alcohol advertising. And I think you mentioned earlier, Minister, that that the Scottish Government were looking at this as part of the new framework. I suppose a number of questions arise from that in terms of the evidence that we've had, is whether the Scottish Government believes the self-regulatory regimes for alcohol advertisements are adequate at this point.
Well, I suppose the short answer to that is no. We know that self-regulatory regimes are not, we know the limitations, if we like, on the limitations of self-regulation, and we do think we should be more ambitious. Most of that is not devolved, and I've written to the UK government on a number of occasions to push them to take action on this issue. And we can't tackle advertising on our own. But as I said earlier on, The advertising is one area where we would like to do more, and it was a key theme of the GAPA-C conference, and we are engaging with a number of people from throughout the world as to see what other countries have done in this area, and that's definitely part of the alcohol strategy that we'll be trying to take forward.
Yeah, that's good to hear, Minister. Can you say more about the discussions you've had with the Scottish Government, have had with the UK Government about strengthening UK controls and alcohol advertising and sponsorship?
Apart from writing letters, I'm afraid there hasn't, as far as I'm aware, been deep discussion about this. Not particularly interested in engaging.
Does any officials know about any previous, the minister's recently imposed, does any of the officials know about, can say anything about the discussions between UK Government and Scottish Government and advertising strengthening?
We have frequent conversations with our counterparts in other governments. It's fair to say that the interest in taking forward some change in this area varies across different governments, but it's something that we continue to push for ourselves very strongly.
Well, what does that mean that you haven't had any meetings with UK government specifically about strengthening their proposals on advertising and some of the, is that what that means?
In the context of the early stages of the framework, I confirm that I haven't had a specific meeting to talk about this specific proposal, but we're at the early stages of the framework,
and
we would intend to do that. But as the Minister says, she's written on a number of occasions, and we do seek to engage those where the power rests.
Okay. I think I can take the answer from. It wasn't a trick question. I'm just trying to, cover the beef of the committee here. What particular enforcement concerns do the Scottish Government have about the proposals of the bill in regards to the restrictions on alcohol advertising?
We're concerned that this new offence wouldn't add to the existing restrictions on promotions that are applied as licence conditions. A breach of current restrictions would be picked up by the licensing standards officer and could lead to the premises licence being revoked.
Colin?
Do you want to add? It was really just a follow-on from what you asked earlier on, convener, and good morning to you, Minister. In terms of the way alcohol sponsorship in sport and the relationship they have with sport, there's obviously a long-standing link, thinking in terms of the money that goes through, for instance, golf club bars, football, rugby, the whole strategic approach with competition sponsorship and all the rest of it. If we were to restrict this on a far higher level in terms of this and also trying to get people into sport, obviously youngsters and the likes, how do you reckon that could be done without seriously inflicting problems in finance of sport in this country? Because it does seem to me that alcohol licensing, particularly, we have the strategic stuff, as I say, Rugby World Cup, the Ryder Cup, all these sort of things, but also in local aspects in terms of supporting our clubs. So has there been an assessment of the hit that sports clubs might financially make or have if licensing was so restrictive or sponsorship was so restrictive in that matter?
I think that we're at the early stages of looking at the impact. But the through the Scottish Government Alcohol Industry Partnership, alcohol sponsorship guidelines for Scotland were published in February 2009. And a review of the guidelines was conducted by Ipsos Mori in 2012. And concluded that they were viewed very positively by the research participants. So The Portman Group led the development of the UK-wide sponsorship guidelines, which were incorporated incorporated content from the Scottish guidelines, and the UK guidelines were launched in January 2014. But in general terms, you know, how sport would be affected if there weren't alcohol industry backing them. As I say, work still needs to be done on that. But I think in Scotland, we, and certainly people like Dr. Peter Rice thinks that there, you know, there are a lot of other industries that could be involved in sponsoring sport, that it might not affect sport too much, but there's still we're still at the initial stages of that work.
I'm sorry, just to clarify that last point, is that I'm not aware of the work done by that person you just referred to, but was that in an anecdotal basis, or is it
it's on an anecdotal basis.
Okay, thanks.
Richard Lyle.
Thank you, Nina. Can I ask in regards to fixed penalty offences? It's been suggested that Police Scotland are very supportive of this bill, but in regards to the fixed penalty, they've made comments that there's significant revision of ASBO fixed penalty tickets, given the reference to discount periods. Bill makes reference to paragraphs 2 and 3. Departure from current ASBO tickets would have to be that would be paid to the Scottish Court and Tribunal Service. Police Scotland also have concerns about transferring ticket information to local authorities. They also point out that the bill would require the withdrawal of all standard antisocial behaviour ticket books from police officers, and the police officers would need to be issued with new ticket information. Is that another concern that you have about this bill, Minister?
I think we would like to explore the costs involved in this area a bit further. I don't know if you want to say in a bit more about
that. I think that picks up on what I was saying earlier, that in order for us to adopt a proposal, we would want to understand what the cost to all parties would be, and understand its efficacy a little bit better. So yes, it is of concern that Police Scotland have raised some costs, and I think it just points to us that a number of ideas require further exploration before we could undertake to support them.
So basically, cost to police, cost to grocers, costs that are unquantified, and that's all the concerns that you have, and that's one of the main reasons why you don't support this bill.
I think the costs involved can be substantial. I think the financial memorandum was scrutinised by the Finance Committee, and they were concerned about the costs involved. But at the end of the day, we want to make sure that any legislation is reducing alcohol-related harm, whether it be to the individual and communities. And I think that is the bottom line of any legislation. Will this work in terms of reducing alcohol-related harm and Scotland's unhealthy relationship with alcohol?
Thank you, Councillor
Simpson.
I think, like Malcolm Chisholm, I was shocked to see rejection of all 10 proposals. And I just say to the Minister, you will, have seen the notes on the discussion that I had with your predecessor about the bill, which originally had 14 items in it, and we dropped 4, which were going to be taken up by the government under matters that weren't legislation. But I'm really interested today in the principles. You've rejected the proposal on what is effectively beer and cider multi-packs. So you're giving a very clear message to the industry that anything they do to try and get round the wishes of Parliament in respect of volume discounting, and that's the principle here. It's not about promotions. It's not about that side of things, which has Carole Baker-Munro has indicated very clearly would be illegal. You can't do that under the rules. But in terms of the volume discounting, it has been very successful in relation to wine, but it has not been successful in relation to beer or cider. And what you're doing today by rejecting this and suggesting to the committee that they reject the bill, on that item, you are saying you're quite happy for the industry to get round volume discounting. Even if it doesn't produce a major change, it would give a clear message to the industry that, just like the tobacco industry, you should not get round the wishes of Parliament. But you're quite comfortable with that.
No, I didn't say that, and I'm not comfortable with that. We do want to do all we can in terms of volume discounting, but what we're saying is that we are limited in what we can do in this area because it's cross-border, and we do believe that that what's proposed here is not going to have the intended outcome.
So, saying to the industry that you're no longer selling single cans or single bottles, in order that you can discount at 4, 8, 12 and 20, you're saying that that is perfectly acceptable and that you're not prepared to do anything about it, because it's clearly within your powers, because the presiding officer wouldn't have said it was legislatively competent if it didn't, wouldn't have allowed it to go forward otherwise. So, and I don't understand your remark about cross-border, Minister. It's got nothing to do with cross-border. Any more than the wine discounting has got to do it. Now, we've got rid of 3-for-2 wine, and we've had a very great success in that. There's been a very significant reduction in wine consumption in Scotland, but there's been a zero reduction in beer consumption. And part of the reason for that is because the industry has got round it. Retailers have got round it. They no longer sell. I was in my co-op yesterday, and actually they were selling single bottles, but they were labelling it slightly differently. They were getting round this intent of Parliament, and you are supporting it by objecting to this. There is no, it is within legislative competence. That is not an argument.
Dr. Simpson, what I can say to you is that if we can legislate on this in terms of refreshing and the next stage of the alcohol framework, we will certainly look at it. But we believe that it should be incorporated in the alcohol framework rather than in a bill by itself. Or with these other...
I see. So the argument is not about whether it's good or whether it's bad or whether it's a good principle or a bad principle. It's just you'd like it to go into a different setup. OK, can we move on then? The next one is age discrimination. This is another principle. There is quite clear evidence that actually doing things to people under the age of 21 and discriminating against responsible adults is regarded as being inappropriate by many of the respondents to my bill. Yet you are now saying that you're quite perfectly happy that although Parliament passed legislation in the 2010 Act saying that there should not be this age discrimination, the fact that it is still allowed for individual licensees to be required to do this is appropriate, that age discrimination. The bill doesn't stop an individual licensee saying, I'm not going to sell to any group. They don't have to sell to anyone they don't want to sell to. But you're saying that it's perfectly appropriate to allow powers to be in place on the principle you can discriminate on the basis of age.
Well, we believe that it is the right power that exists to ensure that local restrictions can be applied, limiting off-sales at outlets with particular problems or who have been found guilty of an infraction of the law. And I understand that in response to the committee's call for evidence, some licensing boards commented that they would prefer to retain the flexibility to introduce a minimum age limits themselves where appropriate. And that's why we're not supporting this at this time.
Okay. The third thing is that the whole principle of this bill is to tackle not alcohol dependency, which I spent much of my life treating. And I think we've done a lot on that. I think the community payback orders are there. I've tabled questions as to how often the alcohol treatment requirement is in place. And also the question of the CPO and how that works. But what this bill is about is actually trying to address those who are just beginning to get into trouble. Just beginning to get into trouble. Because that provides an opportunity. When someone is beginning to get into trouble, that provides an opportunity to say to them, look, this is something you maybe should think about. So it offers a chance with fine diversion to say, you know, if you wish, voluntarily, you can reduce your fine or eliminate it by going for alcohol education. But you're saying that you don't think that the Fife pilot, which they found bureaucratically difficult, it was a workaround, not something in law, you found you don't think that that's actually worthwhile doing. Or it's, even though Newcastle are telling us it's a no-brainer, you think it's not worthwhile doing. Because, you know, at the moment, there is no challenge to these individuals. They're given a fine in almost every area except Fife in Scotland. They're given a fine and that's the end of the matter. Nobody says to them at that point, look, you really should do something about this.
I don't think that's the case. I mean, I think there are lots of diversionary activities on the go where people who are on the cusp of having a problem with alcohol and antisocial behaviour can be diverted away from that. So, as Carole said previously, we intend to look at the initiative that happened in Fife and see whether that is a good prospect for inclusion in the next stage of the alcohol framework.
I think my last item, because I realise time is moving on, Chair, is the question of the bottle marking scheme. You seem to have accepted completely the Morrison's deposition that it's 3.7 million, but as the convener said, it's quite clear this measure is intended to be short-term, not permanent. It's not intended to be a national scheme. It's intended to be focused where the police want to gather intelligence. It's designed to be focused on the individual, I was going to say medicines, but alcohol that is actually being abused. So if White Lightning Cider, for example, or one of these other products is being sold and abused, or indeed others, then the police can ask for that to be done. And it also means that the licensee may be exonerated from it so they can focus elsewhere on it. And I just really fail to understand why a proportionate, focused, short-term measure, which has been costed, we've now got the costings from Newcastle at just over £200, convener, and we'll submit that evidence to the committee. £200 for a 3 month spell of doing this. At a cost of £200, you wouldn't want the police to actually be able to gather this intelligence.
Well, I'd like to see how that £200 is broken down, whether that's the cost to the public purse or whether that includes the cost to the retailers in terms of putting the markings on the bottles. But as we have, as the committee has had in evidence, we know that proxy purchase does happen and that it's not always the youngsters themselves that are trying to buy the alcohol. The alcohol is bought by family and friends and taken from home mostly and perhaps drunk in public. And these are the kinds of things that we don't believe that bottle marking on its own would prevent.
Well, I have to say, I think proxy purchasing is an extremely difficult area and I fully accept that. But there's absolutely no evidence that what we've tried up till now is working.
Well, in Lanarkshire, there is definitely evidence that
I produced my original consultation in 2012 and we're sitting here 3 years later talking about an alcohol framework.
Minister and your colleagues, thank you very much for your attendance here this morning and the evidence that you provided. We will suspend at this point until we change the panel. We now move to our second evidence session of today's meeting, and it is our final evidence session with the member in charge of the Bill on Alcohol Licensing, Public Health and Criminal Justice Scotland Bill. And can I welcome to the committee, not for the first time, Dr. Richard Simpson, MSP, Mary Dinsdale, Senior Assistant Clerk, Non-Government Bills Unit, and Louise Miller, Senior Solicitor, Officer of the Solicitor to the Scottish Parliament. And I understand that Dr. Simpson would like to make a brief statement before we move to questions.
Yes, well, just very briefly, convener, I don't want to take up any more of your time than is necessary. My original consultation, as I was indicating earlier, was in 2012, and I did have a meeting with the Cabinet Secretary to discuss how many of these issues might be resolved without legislation. And in fact, four of the 14 items in my original bill, I was given an indication that these would be pursued by the government, either in their own legislation in the Air Weapons and Licensing Bill, or would be taken up by them without legislative requirement. Regrettably, I haven't seen much evidence of that actually occurring in the 18 months, 2 years since we had our original discussions. I think the most important thing I want to say to this committee is this, that I think that as a parliament, we've done a very good job, and with the addition of minimum unit pricing, which I've always said will actually benefit harmful drinkers. Harmful drinkers will undoubtedly be affected by it. I'm not so sure about the others, but harmful drinkers will be affected by it. But the measures we've introduced or attempted to introduce, I think, have dealt with and deal with the most severe people in our community, people with alcohol dependency, and the legislation really covers that. But the intention of my legislation is, in fact, to tackle a number of areas where it needs tightening in terms of our experience of the legislation that we've already passed. And the second thing is to try and begin to address those who are at the beginning of getting into difficulties with alcohol. Because if you can catch people early, they can be brought up short and realize that they have a problem. And at that point, intervening and intervening quickly actually can have a very, very beneficial effect. So many of the elements in my proposals are designed to tackle that. They are not designed to tackle those with serious violent offending or with alcohol dependency. Those are already covered by existing legislation. So I hope the committee, when it gets to doing its report, will actually look at it in that light and examine it, as I'm sure they will, on the basis of that element.
Thank you, Dr. Simpson. We move to our first questions, which is from Dennis Roberts.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, Dr. Simpson. Can I start off by thanking you for your opening statement, because it actually does help clarify some of the elements around the proposed bill that you're taking forward. And we are looking to whether or not to identify whether it's legislation that is required or whether it's some other means or methods about tackling our relationship with alcohol. With regard to the marking, the container marking in off sales, there's mixed evidence, there's mixed views in with regard to that in terms of its effectiveness with regard against, say, the cost. We've heard, obviously, there's new evidence came from Newcastle, and I'm just wondering, at the end of the day, when we look at the Newcastle situation as a way forward, perhaps, the costing that was suggested for Newcastle, I think it was at 240 for a short term, was it 3 months? Was that for a single off-sales premises, or was it for the whole Newcastle area?
Thank you for your question, Mr. Robertson. It was for a single license premises. Yep. Stickers 0.9p each, posters 90 pence each, and only a couple of posters, some laminated posters as well, but also the time for the beat manager, because they have a system down there where they have a beat manager who deals with the collective licenses. and some time in building relationship with the premises, and then the cost of applying the stickers, which was estimated at about an hour a week. So the total cost was about £200-240 for one licensed premises.
Okay, thank you very much for that. And that cost...
Oh, and I will submit that letter, correspondence from Newcastle in evidence, by the way.
Thank you very much, Dr. Simpson. That cost, did that fall to the licensee or to the licensing board?
No. It isn't actually very clear here who makes up the stickers, but I think they must be done by the Newcastle alcohol organisation. And therefore, whether they charge the licensee or not, the main cost to the licensee is the time to apply the stickers. And that's estimated at an hour a week. Okay. So 12 hours over the 12 weeks.
And that becomes a high visibility in terms of the awareness, in terms of the container marking. There's obviously a suggestion there that it's very evident as to where the alcohol is being sold from, and it can be traced back. Yeah,
it can be traced back. But I think the other thing we should remember is that this actually provides support to the staff in these premises, because the notices are up saying that they're running this scheme, and therefore, in fact, it strengthens their resolve to not sell when they know that people are outside actually waiting to take from the proxy purchaser. So it actually helps the staff as well as others. So it has a preventive measure in this, but it also has an identifying effect as well.
I can see where the intelligence comes from there. Now, perhaps you can help me out here, Dr. Simpson. It is a voluntary scheme and not a legislative programme?
At the moment, it's a voluntary scheme in Newcastle. And the scheme that was run in Dundee was voluntary, and I asked them why they ended it, and they said in part because it was too bureaucratic to manage without legislative support, which is why it went into my bill.
That confuses me to some extent, because I always thought legislation would create more bureaucracy than not. But I'm just wondering. This is where I'm coming from, Dr. Simpson. Is it legislation that is necessary, or is it just the trade, the industry, the licensing boards working together, and Police Scotland working together to identify where there are maybe specific areas that are having an unhealthy relationship with alcohol, to embark on having a voluntary scheme? And is it not something that we could actually perhaps look at within the issuing of licensing, to say that if a certain licensed area or premises starts to have particular problems, that there could be something written in within the license to say that, you know, unless you enter into this voluntary scheme, we can revoke your license or whatever. Does that require the legislation, do you think?
Well, that power has been available to ministers since 2005, and it hasn't been used. That's the first point to make about that. The second thing is that I would expect this to be voluntary on the whole. I would expect and hope that it would be voluntary on the whole, because the cooperation of the licensee is in the licensee's interest very often. But what this legislation provides is the backup. It means that if the police are concerned about a particular area, that they're able to actually impose this with the consent of the licensing board, unless the licensing board, of course, feel that it's not appropriate, in which case they have to give their reasons for it not happening. Mm-hmm. If you take test purchasing, which I was the minister for responsible for asking Mr. Hardy, who was the Lord Advocate at the time, to bring this in, test purchasing. What I've heard about test purchasing is that in some areas it's really very difficult to undertake test purchasing, because the licensee knows the youngsters who are coming in and can spot strangers coming into the area. So it becomes really very difficult. So the bottle marking scheme is to amplify the police intelligence in respect of those elements.
But the bottle marking is only taking gives us the intelligence to take it back to a particular licensed premises. It's not actually saying that, say, a young person who is maybe found with a bottle, say by police, whatever, that young person actually was sold the bottle, because that could well have been sold to that person's parent or whatever, and the bottle removed from the home, as is quite often happens in the majority of cases, I think, Dr. Simpson.
Well, it allows the police to do two things. One is to focus test purchasing, to test what you're talking about there, Mr. Robertson. Yep. And the second thing it does is to allow them to place that licensed premises under surveillance. so that in fact if they see young people coming out from the premises who are underage and are carrying alcohol, it would allow them to immediately intervene. So it provides intelligence at two levels which are not there otherwise.
Okay, and my question therefore, Dr. Simpson, is does it require legislation or does it require a licensed premises along with licence boards working with Police Scotland on a voluntary scheme, which seems to work reasonably well in certain areas, I would suggest at the moment, in targeting certain areas, then we just maybe need to have a look again at when we're issuing licences as to whether or not we need to have something written in to a licence to maybe take the, people to sort of enter into, and obviously it would be voluntary, we can't make it mandatory, but unless there's specific problems arising. My question, do we actually require the legislation to do that? Now, you've said we've got legislation already, but we just don't use it. Is it not a question that we should be using the existing powers that we have and raising that awareness to encourage more voluntary schemes?
Well, I think that once you introduce legislation and then regulations, you will actually have a scheme that then can be implemented very rapidly instead of it having to be rediscussed in every area on every occasion in which it's raised. So I think that the purpose of legislation is to make this whole process much more smooth. And as I said previously, the Dundee scheme, which did work, they stopped because it was they found that it was too difficult on a voluntary basis. If a licensee refuses at the moment, then they can refuse, and that's the end of it.
And Convener, with my perhaps my last question on this, with regard to the cost, the Finance Committee raised concerns in the financial memorandum that you were unable to sort of cost this. Now, we've got some sort of cost from Newcastle, but the estimated cost coming from the trade was 3.7 million across the board. Now, you've said that we're looking at things only happening on a short-term basis. I think you've suggested maybe 3 months to target specific areas. What's right? What do you think that the 3.7 million is a wildly exaggerated cost?
If there was a national scheme, which was the much of the evidence was based on the supposition, false, I have to say, supposition, that this was going to be a national scheme in which all alcohol in Scotland would have to be bottle marked all the time, and that just simply is not the case. So by making it focused, making it temporary, making it on particular drinks for a specific length of time, focusing on licensed premises where the police already have some concerns within an area, the costs would be at the lower end and nothing, I mean just absolutely nothing like 3.73 million. But of course, if there is a Morrison's, and it was Morrison's who gave this evidence, if there is a Morrison's which is actually not following through on things in the way that we'd want them to, then they might have to bear a significant cost. But I think that's extremely unlikely. I think these stores are very reputable, and I don't think that there is a major difficulty in that regard.
And forgive me, Convener, but I did say it was my last, but just to follow on from that is, do you not think that young people are intelligent enough then to move on somewhere else where there isn't a marked scheme? If you've got a marked scheme that can be traced back and they've got the intelligence, do you not think they would move on to somewhere else that this couldn't be, if it's not a national scheme, if it were not marking all bottles and all premises, that it would just go to places where this scheme isn't?
There's always that possibility, Mr. Robertson, but unless you actually have something which tries to address the problem, then you're just throwing your hands in the air and saying, well, that's it, we're not going to try
and address
it.
I'm not saying we're not trying to address the problem. I'm just sort of giving an example that I would have thought that young people, if they thought that somewhere has a marked scheme, that they'd probably move on somewhere else.
I don't want to be too kind to you, Dennis, in terms of your question, in case anybody casts it up, you know. So, Mike, you haven't asked a question today. A pleasure to take you in.
Thank you, Convener. It's just a bit of clarification on this that I'm seeking from Dr. Simpson, that you say that this is designed to be a targeted measure where the police already have suspicions, and you mentioned that that it would allow them to, for instance, undertake surveillance on a premises that they suspect where, you know, selling is taking place to people underage, and therefore perhaps view underage youngsters emerging from the premises, clutching their bottles or cans or whatever it is they're buying. Now, I'm not quite sure what this adds. If it's, and I'm hoping you can explain it to me, if the police are already have some suspicions, what is it? What is there currently to prevent them undertaking surveillance and apprehending youngsters if they're emerging, you know, with alcohol that they're not old enough to buy?
Well, I think normally, as I understand it, what happens is that youngsters are found in a park or a public place consuming alcohol, and at that point the police don't know where this alcohol has been purchased. They may have suspicions, in which case they'll probably be doing test purchasing in that area. If they don't need additional intelligence, they won't actually seek additional intelligence. That's why I'm saying it should be police-led.
Yeah, no, I'm just a bit confused. I'm going back to your answer to one of Mr. Robertson's questions. You'd said then specifically that it would allow police to undertake surveillance and so on. So I'm struggling. If it's targeted, then presumably the police already have suspicions about a particular premises.
Or an area.
If it's not targeted, then they're just casting a wide net. And it seems to me this is the difficulty I've got here. And, you know, when I add that to the difficulty of in securing a conviction, that proof of, you know, merely holding a bottle or can that's been marked is not proof of purchase, direct proof. I'm really struggling to see what this adds, and I'm hoping you can maybe explain it to me.
Well, I wouldn't have continued to move it, Mr. McKenzie, if I hadn't had police support on this.
Indeed, but the police, as we all can be wrong about things.
Oh, well, fine. If you think the police are wrong on this matter, then you will come to the conclusion that you seem to be coming to. But in my view, if the police are saying to me that they feel this measure is a worthwhile addition in terms of their obtaining intelligence, then I have to say my view would be to support the police in this respect.
Well, I can only comment that I'd hope that you'd have been able to articulate the police position so that we can have the benefit of understanding it, merely than asking us to accept that the police are inevitably always correct in their opinions. Are you able to articulate...
I'm not saying the police are inevitably correct in their opinions on everything. I'm saying in this respect, the information I obtained from the police when I consulted them before tabling my bill was very positive. If it had not been positive, I would not have tabled this section of the bill. That's all I'm saying.
The committee have participated, Mike, on the ground. We have watched it and we've got a report there. So the committee have satisfied themselves in terms of whether we support this or not, that this can work. We saw it in operation and we've got notes of it and whatever. We did take some evidence from the police as a committee. I've got Bob. And then Malcolm.
Yeah, I think it's useful to say that I didn't go to Newcastle, Dr. Simpson, but those that went there saw the benefit of a voluntary scheme. Yeah. And that's as far as the evidence goes. I think that's reasonable to say. And where this hangs for me, I suppose, is whether it should be voluntary or whether it should be compulsory. And if there is compulsion, who should decide on the compulsion and whether that's desirable? So these are the things I'm working through in my head, Dr. Simpson. So I won't rehearse my concern about the police having that leverage in terms of the licensing process. That is a concern that I have. And when I ask my substantive question, if you want to respond to that, feel free, Dr. Simpson. But I won't focus on that. But that is a concern that I do have. You'll have heard that in the last evidence session. I suppose I was just slightly confused in relation to this would be led by police suspicions, and then you could have a targeted approach, and then that could lead to intelligence to provide for a test purchase scheme. But you said in your evidence there's limitations to a test purchase scheme, but then you also said that this labelling scheme would drive us towards test purchasing. So I did see a contradiction there in relation to that, and you might want to respond to that. But I suppose where this has worked, and perhaps it worked in Dundee, I've not looked at that in any detail, what we have to look at is sharing best practice for, in my view, so far, voluntary schemes, wherever they are in Scotland, so we can have a degree of consistency and we can have a degree of certainty. Maybe parts of Scotland would like to roll out voluntary schemes in partnership, but they lack the confidence to do that. So I'm just wondering, Dr. Simpson, if this wasn't to be successful in this bill, whether you'd be keen to work with the refreshed alcohol framework to drive in what best practice would look like in this area to achieve that kind of consistency across Scotland.
Well, I think in answer to your last point, I mean, I haven't spent a considerable proportion of my professional life working with people with alcohol problems to say no, that obviously I will do all in my power to assist in developing the framework. I think in respect of the initial point, Mr. Doris, I would certainly hope that this would be voluntary in most areas and the police wouldn't need to exercise this power. But if a licensee refused, they have no power to coerce them at the present time. The police have no power to coerce them. This legislation would allow them to require this, provided that licensing board had not good reason to say otherwise, which they might. I don't know what those reasons might be, but they might choose to say no, in which case they would have to give their reasons for it. So I think we've tried to get a balance here of allowing the police to actually develop this. I mean, the police will receive complaints from the public about public drinking by underage people. And to act on that, they then need to gather intelligence. And this process is designed to do that.
I mean, I take on board what you're saying. We just have that genuine slight disagreement in relation to the role of the police in relation to the licensing board. Yeah. I take that, that's just where we are. I'm just wondering whether or not you think it would be a reasonable consideration of any licensing board when they're looking to renew a liquor licence, if they deemed it to be an unreasonable lack of partnership working from an off-licence, should they decide not to partake of a labelling scheme in a local community. I mean, I'm being slightly flippant, but if off-sales are proud of the good, responsible job they do, then why wouldn't you want your bottle of wine with a little label on it promoting the store that it was bought from, if you're ethically sound in your selling of liquor? But I suppose the substantive question would be, do you think that would be a reasonable consideration for a licensing board to take into account when they look to renew or extend any liquor licences, how much, if you like, on a voluntary basis, that kind of partnership work did or didn't happen in local communities?
You're making quite an interesting point, Mr. Doris. The trouble is that since 2005, under the Licensing Act, licences are not renewed. There isn't a periodic review system in this country now. We used to have that, but we don't have it now. It was part of lightening the load on because we were imposing a lot of other conditions. I mean, I was the minister that started that whole process off with the Nicholson review. And we knew that would place a greater burden on licensees, so we decided to remove the periodic review. So there isn't a renewal of license system which would allow the licensing board to step in and say, your renewal's being denied because you've refused to participate in this partnership. So that's another reason for having this in legislation. I don't see this legislation having to be used, I have to say. I think once the legislation's in place, the licensees will agree. But having it there as a backstop, very often, having a legislation in place as a backstop is valuable.
Just a final comment, and I'll let my colleagues in. I'm not sure that's a reason to back this section of the bill, but that's certainly a reason for both the respective parties to consider whether we got that 2005 measure accurate or otherwise. And I suspect neither of us really know where either of our parties are going in relation to that. But I think it's an interesting point that I was unaware of, Dr. Simpson, and I'll certainly reflect on. So thank you.
Well, I think that's, to be fair to the government, they've partially realised that with the Air Weapons and Licensing Bill, that the collection of information from licensing boards has been really very poor. We have really little idea about what the individual licensing boards are doing. They're not reporting, for example, as you heard this morning, on whether ASBOs are being used at all in relation to the minor offences that we're talking about in this bill. We just don't know.
That was one of my questions I was going to come to you later, but other colleagues want, and they may come to that ahead of myself, Dr. Simpson, but I'll return to that hopefully at some point.
Malcolm Chisholm.
I mean, I see this as a coherent set of measures
that's trying to address the abuse of alcohol in general, but also some measures obviously focusing particularly on young people and alcohol. So I'll not concentrate on areas where I'm kind of very much in support of what you're saying. I'll just ask about two areas where I have a bit of uncertainty. I mean, given the focus on as I described in my first sentence, on abuses of alcohol and particularly on, in certain places, on age. It just feels that the age discrimination in off sales, it doesn't somehow seem to fit within that coherent framework. I mean, you'll explain your reasons for introducing it, but I suppose it could be argued that that is another targeted measure that's trying to deal with abuses of alcohol in certain premises. I mean, we've been talking about bottle marking, which would be focused on certain premises. So it's certainly in some of the evidence, some licensing boards are saying it's a useful tool for dealing with premises that persistently sell to under 18. So, I mean, I understand the contrary arguments, but in a kind of way, it seems to be not with the general thrust of the bill. Let's put it that way.
I don't know if you remember, Mr. Chisholm, but when we discussed this in the original bill in 2010, one of our most eminent statisticians said the evidence on this was extremely poor. There was not good evidence to have a blanket, as it was proposed then, discrimination on an area where licenses within an area, none of them would be allowed to sell to under 21. The evidence from the pilots that were done was extremely poor. Now, the other thing is, in my view, that the people who are actually more likely to be in difficulties with alcohol or having problems with alcohol are actually those slightly older, 21 to 25, because they've got more money. The ones under 21 are not. So discriminating against those under 21, you know, doesn't seem to me to have any significant rational basis. So this removes the discriminatory thing completely. And it's simply that there is no evidence that I have that, in fact, doing this would be an appropriate thing. And it can have a negative effect, just as, you know, the fact of stop and search has a negative effect about youngsters' attitude towards police. If you start introducing measures which are not evidence-based to block sales under people from 18 to 21 when they are adults and in terms of law are entitled to purchase, then I think you create a feeling which is negative, and that I don't think is particularly. If there was a significant advantage to it, I would see the purpose, but there is no proof that this actually is something that is of benefit at all.
And the other one that, I mean, I'm quite open-minded about it myself, but it was very noticeable that there was, I think it was the one measure that had most opposition, was actually notification of an offender's GP. So again, although as I say I am open-minded, it would seem difficult to implement a measure that had such widespread opposition, particularly from the medical profession. So I wonder what your thoughts on that are.
Yes, it was perhaps a decision which I need to look at again in the light of the evidence. In the consultation, we got a negative response from the BMA and a negative response from the courts on the grounds of administrative costs. My concern again is that the fact that the court's own estimates are that there are 50,000 people coming in front of them every year and are receiving disposal, about which nothing is then done. Nothing. And in 30 years as a general practitioner, the information I got from the courts were on serious offences. That was something that came through. It was often in the press, in fact, so one picked it up and one would then try to address it. But or there was a treatment requirement, which we've got powers to do for the more serious offence. But for the minor offences, as a GP, I was actually never informed. Now, the APBIs are a scattergun approach. GPs will try and focus it as best they can. But if they had this additional information, in my view, that they would actually then focus the brief interventions more specifically on some of these 50,000 who may be at the beginning of their alcohol career, as it were. So that was the purpose of it. But in the light of the fairly outright opposition from all sides, that's something that I would want to reconsider perhaps before stage one. But I'll look forward to seeing the committee's report in respect of that particular item in the bill.
Okay, thanks. Richard Lyle.
Thank you, Convener. Dr. Simpson, can I move on to alcoholic drinks containing caffeine? Your bill would introduce a ban on alcoholic drinks with a caffeine content above a level to be set by Scottish ministers. But you then goes on to say that sales of this type of drink is only a very small percentage of alcohol sales in Scotland. But you then go on to suggest that research has shown that 5,000 crimes are committed in Strathclyde committed by people drinking a certain level, certain type of caffeinated tonic wine. And you then go on to suggest that if we do amend the caffeine within these drinks, that there'll be a substantial reduction in crime. I thought crime was at an all-time low in the last 40 years. Why would you suggest that if we change the caffeine content of a drink, that crime will then fall?
I'm not suggesting overall crime will fall, Mr. Lau. Crime is actually falling in every developed country. Irrespective of whether they increase or decrease police, it is reducing in every developed country. So, you know, that is not something I'm suggesting. What I'm suggesting here is that there is considerable evidence from the states that that caffeine in a particular strength mixed with alcohol creates wide awake drunks, which places people at greater risks, makes them more likely to be aggressive. And the reports from the McKinley report on young offenders in Polmont and the report from Strathclyde Police were the two reports that led me to propose this. I'm very disappointed at the fact that the government haven't seen fit to carry out any further research into this issue. It is confined to the west of Scotland. As Peter Rice made very clear to you, he practices in Tayside, and if you're in Tayside, this particular problem is not a problem. It is as much a cultural thing as anything. But there is no doubt that there are two jurisdictions where it has been substantially changed. One is in America, where the Food and Drug Administration haven't banned it. What they said to the producers was, you will now have to prove that your product is safe. And interestingly enough, the producers then stopped producing caffeine alcohol mixed drinks. Completely. It just simply stopped. And the second jurisdiction is in Denmark, where they introduced a restriction which has been notified to the EU and accepted by the EU, where they have restricted the level of caffeine in the drinks. And they did so on the basis of the evidence, as they saw it, of problems that they were having with caffeine alcohol mixed drinks. So I'm not saying this is a major problem in terms of the overall consumption of alcohol, but I am saying that as a cultural thing in the west of Scotland, it could be worth addressing by carrying out further research, perhaps, and then introducing a restriction. And I would hope that that's exactly what would happen.
In regard to one more question, Convener, if you allow me, container marking off sales. I know particularly we were talking about major stores, and I'll maybe not name the store I'm thinking of, but a major store that has two aisles of substantial amount of drink, and about half a mile away there are two within half a mile radius of this major store that I'm thinking of, there are two off-licence premises. If there was a concern by the police in an area or residents complaining to the police, would you not think that then the three places that sell the drink would have to do this container marking, and the cost would actually be more than what you're suggesting of £200-odd?
Well, it's certainly true that if they had suspicions about the major store as opposed to smaller stores undertaking this, then it could be a more significant cost for them. But remember, we're talking about focused drinks as well as focused time, as well as focused premises. So the number of drinks that would actually have to be tagged would not be very significant in terms of what the major supermarkets are actually selling. It would be particular products that they would be looking at. So in the evidence that's been given to your committee, Convener, is on the basis that all the alcohol in the two aisles of that store would have to be marked.
And who would mark it? The evidence we got was it would need to be the council officer would come in and mark it.
No.
Are you saying that the store would mark
it? The store would mark it.
Okay, thank you.
On the stickers being provided by the...
Thank you, Convener.
You mentioned in the caffeinated drinks, Dr. Simpson, that you know further research is required. So are we ahead? Are you ahead of yourself here in terms of you're almost meeting the Scottish Government's view here in terms of has the case been made? If you concede further research, then is that the implication that the case really needs to be made?
Well, I feel that, you know, dialogue is really very important. And I think that when I raised this issue in 2012 with the government, and indeed we raised it in the 2010 Act and the 2011 Act, we did raise the issues of the caffeine. In the first instance, it was felt that there wasn't sufficient evidence. In the second instance, it was ruled out on competence grounds. But we have been pressing, I've been pressing this issue, or others in my party have been pressing this issue really now for some 5 or 6 years. The only evidence we have are the McKinley study and Strathclyde police study, although also there's a report from the Glasgow City Council on the quantities of broken glass resulting from this particular product, which, you know, but that really hasn't been completely quantified. It's more anecdotal, but it's suggested it's really very significant. So that there are three bits of evidence that indicate that it is a significant problem in the west of Scotland, and I think there could be no doubt about that. The question is whether whether it should be introduced with further research or in the light of further research. I certainly think, in the light of the fact of the discussions that I've seen and the evidence that I've had, that it might be worthwhile changing the requirement on the minister to introduce it within a year, allowing the minister to undertake some further research, but at least having it on the books as an indication that we think this is a serious problem, and that the evidence that we've got so far does indicate that in this particular area of the west of Scotland, it's a serious problem.
In relation to Pete, I think it was Peter Rice's evidence, I mean, and we had a discussion there about maybe the bucky in that west of Scotland area, and it's got its reputation, and that's the drink of choice to get out your head. And if we'd done a similar study in the northeast, it would maybe be another drink.
Yes.
With a similar reputation, maybe cider or whatever, that would be impacting, along with other things, on the behaviour of some of the other young men who were in a similar institution. It would be, is it not just the excess of alcohol and the cultural aspects of that, not necessarily Buckfast?
Convener, I've never denied that there may be a displacement effect, which is effectively what Peter Rice was saying, that if that cultural thing is dealt with, it won't be another drink that comes along. But there is a difference, and that is caffeine in the strength that's contained in these drinks actually is a stimulant, whereas alcohol itself is a depressant.
Yeah.
If you drink sufficient alcohol, the majority of people, not absolutely everyone, but the majority of people will actually go from being wide awake to being rather passive, and then actually to being comatose, because it is a depressant. If you add in caffeine in significant strength, drunk in significant quantities, then you produce wide awake drunks who are actually likely to be more aggressive for longer, less in control of themselves. And it's the combination of caffeine and alcohol that gives me the concern in terms of the criminality, based on the report in the Young Offenders Unit, which showed the high numbers who drunk this particular substance and had got themselves into serious difficulties. But enough to go to prison.
The point that was made at that session as well, it's become very popular to mix spirits with high energy drink, caffeine drinks. You know, so if you take that principle, then you would need to extend it to bars and mixers and goodness knows what, wouldn't you, if you were saying that?
Well, I think you have to make a far greater, if it's readily available in a pre-mixed drink, then you can take it out into the community and you can drink it, and that's what happens. That's why there's all the broken glass. This is not something being consumed in bars. This is something that's being consumed largely in the community, in groups, where they then get into trouble. And that's why it needs to be addressed. Whereas I think things like Jaeger bombs, which I hear from my children, grandchildren, can be popular, but other mixed drinks of that sort, may get people into difficulty. And I suspect they do get them into some difficulty, particularly in a situation or circumstances more like that in America, where women, for example, indulging in this are much more exposed to sexual risk. So, yes, there are risks associated with caffeine mixed drinks, but you cannot stop somebody actually mixing the drink, but you could stop them consuming the pre-mixed drinks.
Rhoda Grant.
Can I ask about alcohol awareness training?
Yeah,
one of the reasons the Scottish Government was giving for not supporting this part of the bill was the cost of setting up courses all over Scotland. I'm not sure how many courses you think should be available in Scotland. It would be good to get some evidence on that. But bearing in mind that in the press today, a similar alternative to having speeding points is only available in England for those who wish to take it up. I wonder if you foresee many centres of providing this training in Scotland.
In my view, every alcohol and drug partnership should be providing alcohol awareness. If you pick people up, for example, in arrest referral, which was in my original bill, we only had arrest referrals in 5 sheriffdoms. I've tabled a question to ask whether the undertaking I was given by the minister at the time of the discussions that wasn't necessary to legislate on, because it would be spread to every sheriffdom and every alcohol drug partnership. If you're on arrest referral, you may not have a serious alcohol problem. You may have just had that one occasion in which you have been arrested in relation to alcohol. But if you're then offered the opportunity of alcohol awareness training, I think that's an entirely appropriate thing to do. Of course, if you have a dependency, then you need to be offered something considerably more than that. But for us not to have the low-level alcohol awareness training available as an alternative to fines or as a method of reduction for the drink banning order, because it's engaged in that as well, incentives for these individuals to actually ameliorate the current situation, which is they simply get a sentence or a disposal, and that's the end of it. By giving them that alternative, I think that we will, in fact, and the evidence is there from the Fife report, and also I gather from Newcastle, that if you offer this, as people will take it up, and they're then less likely to reoffend. That is protecting our communities, but it's also helping those individuals. And I find it astonishing that we actually don't have that level of awareness training in every alcohol and drug partnership as we speak.
Are you saying that this could be a cost-saving measure, and that if people are unlikely to reoffend, then the cost to the state would be less and would certainly cover the cost of the training?
Ms. Grant, in my experience, people do not start off with a massive, harmful drinking problem, or indeed beyond that with alcohol dependency. It is something that they go through, often starting too young with drinking, and some of that's been improved considerably, but they start off drinking too young and they progress through a series of steps. The step that we do not address at the present time is that when they begin to get into trouble, they are not actually given the opportunity of addressing that. And that's what my bill seeks to do with the two measures. One is the binge drinker who gets into trouble on a couple of occasions and gets a drink banning order, being able to say, right, well, look, you could actually reduce this significantly by going on an alcohol awareness course. And the other one is fine diversion. Because the moment you just pay your fine, that's the end of it. No one actually gets you to, offers you the opportunity of addressing it.
Thank you.
Okay. Any other committee members? Bob?
Thanks, convener. I was going to ask about drinking banning orders, and I will, but I was wondering if part of your answer to Rhoda Grant was talking about that sometimes when people have a kind of interaction with the law for a negative reason where drink was involved, it might not always be necessary to refer them to some kind of support intervention, brief intervention, because it may be a kind of one-off. I thought I heard you say that. I could be wrong, in which case I apologise if you didn't say that. I'll check the official report. But I'm just kind of saying, using the same logic, then why would we inform a GP every single time? And if I picked you up wrong, I apologise, Dr. Simpson, but I thought I heard you say that in relation to Part 8 of the bill. And if that's true in Part 8 of the bill, surely it's true at Part 10 of the bill.
If people are given the drink banning order, or if people are getting into trouble and they do not accept the opportunity and the incentive to ameliorate their disposal, reduce their disposal by going voluntarily into an alcohol awareness program, then by informing the general practitioner, it allows a second bite at the cherry, because the GP often has a much better, a really good relationship with their patients, and therefore saying to them, well, I see that you've got into trouble over alcohol. Was this a one-off, or is it something that's happened once or twice? Or, I think that we should actually do an alcohol brief intervention with you. And that, remember, is partly signposting on So it allows the GP the opportunity of identifying the group who haven't responded to the incentive that we're that we'll be offering with this bill.
I mean, I won't explore that further. I think we have a genuine disagreement in relation to whether that's the appropriate intervention by a GP, but that wasn't the reason for asking it. I'll go back and check the wire, I'm sure. Maybe I just misheard that exchange, in which case I apologise.
I'm sorry, I don't follow the point you're trying to make.
So I think what I'll do is, rather than progress a point that may have led to me mishearing what you said, Dr. Simpson, I'll maybe go to my substantive point, and I'll go back and look at the wire. So apologies for.
And I'd be happy for the committee to write to me if it's not clear.
I won't explore that any further. But in drinking banning orders, the government position is that we can use ASBOs in relation to this, and there was a lack of data on whether that tends to happen or not happen. Can I ask you, Dr. Simpson, have you tried to garner any of that data yourself?
I have tried informally and not succeeded.
Right.
That there's no evidence that ASBOs are being used in that particular regard. They are used if they're part of a neighbourhood, of a neighbour nuisance situation in which alcohol plays a part, then the ASBO, there is an ASBO can be put on it. But ASBOs as a specific measure to stop somebody entering licensed premises or an area with licensed premises, I have got no evidence of at all. And you know, unfortunately, because there's no requirement on the reporting on this, that, you know, we haven't got it. Although I'll be very interested, having heard the evidence this morning, to see what the government officials come back with in terms of their examination of this. If they find other evidence, I'd find that very useful. But the difference is that an ASBO, as I understand it, you have an ASBO and you have an ASBO for a certain length of time and that's the end of it. The drink banning orders that I'm proposing, as opposed to the community payback, as opposed to the alcohol treatment requirement, this order will allow somebody to actually be offered the opportunity of addressing their problem and it being identified very specifically as alcohol, which ASBOs might not.
Right. But I think you make an interesting point. Can I just maybe check, when you said you tried informally to get the information, how did you do that?
Well, I didn't write to people. I don't think we wrote to them about this. We didn't write to them about it. In fact, it's simply I discussed with one or two people who are on licensing boards as to whether, and one or two councillors, as to whether they were aware of ASBOs being imposed with a specific requirement of this sort. And they said no. But I have absolutely no... this was, as I said, purely anecdotal and just one or two people. It wasn't a formal written request.
That's the thing. You've been very, very straightforward with the committee in relation to that, and I appreciate that. I suppose my concern would be about providing further legislation when there is that information gap, because I put it to you. Okay, here's a supposition which may or may not be true, Dr. Simpson. I'd appreciate your opinion on it, because it does link specifically to drinking banning orders. Could it be possible there's a lack of awareness in how ASBOs could be used in this regard? So that's the first part of it, potentially. Or could the second part be that actually in relation to directing people towards an alcohol brief intervention as part of any community payback or ASBO, and how that links, I appreciate a grey area and how that links, there has to actually be a course available in the first place and enabled to do that, and we don't have a full audit of what is or isn't available, and that's a bit patchwork. So I hope you'll appreciate that's kind of my concern, because if we can use ASBOs more systematically, if that's the right thing to do, and more consistently, I would like to get evidence on that first, rather than put in a second piece of legislation, which by and large, and I appreciate there's some differences, by and large seems to duplicate existing powers that are there. So I'd appreciate your thoughts on that.
Well, I do think that a drink banning order, as the police described it, would be a useful additional item in the toolkit. And I think it being very specific and very focused actually means that it's much more likely to be used, and it would be, in some senses, I think it would be simpler than the ASBO order to use. But, you know, you're quite correct, Mr. Dorris, that unless the government or local authorities out there can come up with evidence saying ASBOs are really very simple, we just hadn't thought of it, then I can't really answer your question fully.
OK. Okay. Now, I did have another question to explore.
Yeah, sure.
Thanks, Doctor. I'm just trying to make sure I've covered as most parts of the bill that I can do. Dr. Simpson, give you an opportunity to put information on the record. And I know you've had an opportunity a little bit earlier, but in relation to point 9, which is alcohol awareness training as an alternative to fixed penalty fines, I think we mentioned that there had been a Fife pilot in relation, was it a Kirkcaldy pilot?
Yes, Fife.
In relation to that, that it rolled out.
Fife Alcohol Support Services ran a pilot.
Yeah, so, I mean, again, it was a case of this may or may not be a pretty desirable thing to do, and there is a tension there, I suppose, now it interacts with any refreshed alcohol framework. So, if a pilot could be undertaken, does that suggest that we don't need the powers in order to do this, but what we actually do need is a more systematic provision of alcohol awareness training across Scotland to allow for this to be rolled out?
Well, I think that the problem, and I may be wrong in this, and I'm sure someone out there will correct me if I've got it wrong, but at the moment what happens, as I understand it, is the police say, we're going to issue a fine to you, but there's this alternative. They don't have, you know, they can't impose the fine and say you're going to ameliorate it by going on this. So it's a workaround, and I think workarounds are not necessarily the best way to proceed. I think it's better to have something which is more generalised and which is very clearly encouraging people to do this. It requires the police on an individual basis, who won't know the person, to actually say, well, I think, you know, maybe they've had them once before and they're saying, well, this is your second fine. You know, would you like to go on this course? It's a workaround situation at the moment. Because once you've imposed the fine at the moment, you don't have the authority to say, well, cancel half the fine, as they do in Newcastle. I don't know how they work it, but they do. I think they cancel half the fine in Newcastle.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I think the committee will seek more information on that, perhaps, before we draft our stage one report. I would suspect, was a final question on alcohol awareness training. Again, this was a pilot in Fife. I'm just wondering, irrespective of whether this bill does or does not progress, would it be your position there has to be a more systematic, structured approach to alcohol awareness training right across Scotland, and whether this is done via pilot, such as in Fife or elsewhere? Likewise, when I was talking about other parts of the bill, the government maybe has to develop a best practice template as part of any refreshed alcohol strategy to make sure we've got a consistent approach right across the country.
Yes, I mean, you'll know that my proposal is that we should test this in an urban setting before we proceed. So, I know I'm wanting to proceed cautiously on this because I need to see that it actually does work, and to find out what the full costs of it would be. Say it was done in Glasgow, the numbers would be obviously considerably greater, you know, it would test out the costs before the government then decided whether to roll it out or not. Now, we have a good history of doing this. We did it with drug treatment and testing orders. I have to say, in that case, the English pilot was not good. The results were very poor. We decided, however, that we liked the idea. We then ran a pilot in Scotland, which we adjusted for the mistakes and the problems that there were in the English system. Our pilot in Scotland was found to be effective and good, and we then rolled it out. And that process took between 2001 and 2006 before we finally had it rolled out. So we do proceed cautiously. We do proceed on the basis of best value and good evidence. And that is exactly what my proposal in respect of alcohol awareness training lays out.
I mean, just a brief reflection, and I won't have any other questions after this, convener. I suspect if we were to legislate, and I know what you're saying about a cautious approach going forward, but legislation does tend to drive change quite dramatically, and you've mentioned that. I hadn't given thought to the costs around this, actually, Dr. Simpson, until you mentioned it, but that expectation that change will be driven without any costings of what that would mean would give me a cause for concern. But I think where I can reach agreement with you, Dr. Simpson, is the need to be much more clear on what costs would look like, and to make sure that best practice is rolled out right across the country, whether it's via legislation or via the alcohol framework. And I think these proposals certainly feeds into that discussion quite helpfully. Thank you, convener.
Thanks.
The pilot scheme would have to be evaluated, and if I can just slightly contradict you, Mr. Doris, although I hesitate strongly to do so, we passed a social responsibility levy in 2010, and if that had been actually implemented by the government, then the price of alcohol might have continued to rise. Now, I understand the public health levy was a substitute for that, and I welcomed it. It was tobacco and alcohol, and only on superstores. That's been abandoned, and we still don't have the social responsibility levy, which would allow for a lot of these costs to be met, because the way that bill is written, that money is to be applied to deal with things like alcohol awareness. So if you add that to the fact that if you can divert one person from a pathway that's going to end up as a harmful drinker, then you are going to save a lot of money.
I'm just minded that we're playing debating tennis, and I apologise, Kevin, and I promise you this is my last comment, I promise you.
Yeah, I promise you it's your last comment.
See, we've got consensus already between the convener and the deputy convener, but you've just drawn attention to another piece of legislation that's already on the statute book, but perhaps isn't rolling out at all or as well as it could be, and I'm just slightly nervous about putting something else out there, but I take on board the comments you make, and I've listened carefully to them, Dr. Simpson.
Thanks. Nanette, I'm hoping you'll come in just to cover the areas about your last question about community. Are you happy to do that now?
Yes. I just wondered if you had any further comment. You'll have heard, obviously, the response to my question about the notification, licence notification.
Yes. My concern all along, convener, has been not the areas where there is a community council that's active. It's the 15 or 16%, and it's mainly in deprived communities where there is no community council and therefore they can't be consulted. And it seems to me four metres is not really an adequate area to consult. I think there needs to be wider consultation. I do think on the basis of the evidence that I've received that 50 metres is over generous, and it maybe shouldn't be a circle, because why would somebody 50 metres, which is 2.5 roads away probably, why would they need to be consulted? So the area to be consulted maybe needs to be better defined. But I think the principle, which is what we're talking about at stage one, the principle of the bill here is that there really must be more consultation with communities who are not currently being consulted. They do feel, and I get correspondence on this, they feel that they're not being adequately consulted, and I think that they should be. So I think that's one aspect of it. And the other aspect is when you do have a community council, they often don't meet at certain times of the year, and therefore a 21-day notice can mean that they don't have a meeting, and if they don't have a meeting, they can't really put a view in. So it then becomes somewhat difficult, and I think extending the time period, it doesn't need to be 42 days, it may need to be 35 or something, but again, I think the extension of that period of time to ensure that our community councils do have the chance to be consulted. Availability is, along with price, the big driver of change in alcohol consumption. And at the moment, as we know now from the crash report, which we finally got, the availability of licences in deprived areas is far more intense than it is in other areas. We need to give these communities the biggest, best possible opportunity to object.
Are you satisfied with the government's response that they would actually be looking at these things as part of their review of...
I would be, but for the fact that I raised this issue in 2012.
Can I return under the heading of minimum package price and return to this issue of proportionality and cost? And that drew a lot of criticism in terms of the trade, about administration. It raised questions in the Finance Committee about specific concerns about the cost and the financial memorandum and all of that. I suppose the question is, the minimum package price, do you believe that that would have a significant income on alcohol consumption? And how do you respond to the concerns that the cost of administration and the costs associated with that proposal outweighs any benefit that may be had from reduced alcohol consumption?
Well, to take the first point, I think that this is a very principled element of the bill. This is about the fact that the industry, the retail industry, has effectively got round Parliament's wishes, which was to end volume discounting. And what this does is it doesn't totally sort it. I accept fully that they could be selling only a box of 18 cans, but you know, a lot of people can't afford 18 cans. It becomes difficult. But you know, the fact that they don't sell single cans in order that they can sell 4, 8, 10, 12 and 20 all at different prices means that they've got the market really well judged. There is no evidence that I've seen that the implementation of the wishes of Parliament in respect of wine has caused any problems. It has been implemented, volume discounting has ended, and the consumption of wine has gone down significantly, quite significantly. So we should have this for beer and cider as well. And so that's the principle of it. The second thing is that the point that West Lothian made, that they would, there'd be a big cost of sending out new licenses to everybody. I think the reply to that is there have been 39 adjustments to licensing and there wasn't a single complaint from any of these boards at the time. The government has adjusted this 39 times. It's only when a private member comes along and suggests another amendment that suddenly we get protests. But not from all. And if I can just quote from the letter I received from the chair of the licensing board in Glasgow, which is our biggest licensing board, and it said, my problem is that with West Lothian has said that this will require all boards to issue revised licenses with a new restriction. And does this have to happen? And the answer is that this would be the same thing for any adjustments to license. If an adjustment is made, then a single sheet can be put out, and it can be put out at the time of year when the mailing normally goes out to the licensing board. So, the cost of it is not going to be, it's a single sheet into a pack that's already going out. So, if what West Lothian are suggesting, then licensing conditions would be frozen in time forever. And that's, not going to happen. So I think that the issue, and I recorded it in greater detail in my evidence to the Finance Committee, which I would ask the clerks to perhaps take a look at and draw to the committee's attention, because I quoted more extensively from the letter. So the costs involved are not going to be significant from introducing a principled measure that reinforces Parliament's original unanimous desire to end volume discounting.
Colin, can I call on you to ask some questions under the heading of restrictions and advertising?
Yeah, thank you for that, convener. As you may have heard in the last few occasions, brought up the issue of the advertising, and particularly the impact it has within sports within Scotland. Obviously, there's the issue of youngsters coming into sport and whatever, but many clubs are reliant on alcohol sponsorship indirectly or directly, whether it's through the bar or at the clubhouse or whatever. But the fact that the advertising seems to have left the sort of middle ground of sporting events and has gone to sort of high level or lower level with the middle bit kind of missing out. Obviously, you see fewer football clubs with, for instance, with the markings on their jerseys these days. However, the sponsorship levels have gone international, so you have such stuff as Champions League, World Cup Rugby, Guinness Pro 12 Rugby, all of these sort of things. So has an assessment been done, do you reckon, or have you heard of anything which may affect the amount of money which is going into sport, which obviously we want to encourage clubs and all that sort of thing? And we've heard an anecdotal note that someone's done some work, reckons that other companies can take the slack up. What's your views on what you might have heard the government or minister saying in terms of this anecdotal stuff? Because it would appear that there possibly is quite a chunk of money that goes into sports which could put pressure on these organisations to actually subsist at the bottom end. But obviously there's the higher end plus the fact that you have the advertising internationally that goes with that.
Yes, the it's the one area I do accept what the government is saying, and that is we don't have the powers to limit advertising in the way that we might wish to or might not wish to, but, you know, we don't actually have that power. But for me, that's not an argument not to use the powers that we do have, and we do have powers. In fact, it was actually the current First Minister who originally looked at this in relation to tobacco and ran up against exactly the same problems that I ran up against. Of course, subsequently, the government in the UK banned tobacco advertising, so it didn't become a problem. And maybe the UK government will have a change of heart, though I very much doubt it, and introduce a ban. The purpose of a total ban, which is what you're, I think, alluding to, is the purpose of that would be to denormalize alcohol as being something that is ubiquitous across society. I mean, it is the amount that's spent on advertising is absolutely vast. Now, as I say, we don't have the power to do that, but we do have the power to introduce some limited measures. What is interesting for me is at the moment you have a situation whereby there is no promotion allowed of alcohol within 200 metres of premises. But if you go to 201 metres and that happens to be somewhere near a school, you're reliant on a voluntary ban. If it's 101 metres from the school and 201 metres from the premises, you can get advertising at the moment. And as you heard from the Minister, voluntary bans, she wasn't very keen on voluntary bans, and I agree with her. I think voluntary bans are not, I think, adequate in regard of something which is so much of a problem, particularly for Scotland. So what I'm proposing, of course, is a 200 metre ban from all schools, creches, play parks, etc. And if you overlap that with the 200 metre ban from premises, then you're going to end up with fairly limited billboard advertising or fixed place advertising within our communities. And I think that is a useful first step. It's not total. It's not an absolute thing, but it is a useful first step in saying to children, you know, that it's not there. Now, the evidence in the tobacco side is very clear, that in fact the recognition of brand names in tobacco has dropped off quite considerably since 2003. But the recognition of alcohol brands is still extremely high. And the evidence from University of Stirling, which I think you heard a little of, indicates that it is very high. So any step we can take legitimately within the powers that we've got to reduce that exposure, in my view, is a step worth taking. It won't go as far as perhaps I would like, but it would at least be a first step in that regard. And I think the final point, as I think I've said before, is that in France they have a total ban. There can be discussion as to whether it's how effective it is, what it's had, but there's no doubt that as part of a collective drive by France in the 80s, which was the Loi Vin was approved in the European courts, was accepted as being a proportionate and effective measure, as one of many measures they introduced, they went from the position we're in today to slightly below the European average in terms of their alcohol problem.
So if I could come back on just a couple of things there. First of all, I think we're agreeing that there's no actual evidence as to what... No one's worked out the effect on sports clubs at a lower end who happen to be surviving partly on alcohol sponsorship. I think of the golf club, rugby clubs, that sort of thing around. But in terms of the French example, I've always found that one slightly odd because they do have a different culture in terms of alcohol, and particularly in terms of access to wine as the... children grow up within the family unit, and the way the French have generally had that as part of their culture over the years. And is there something that actually tells us that what they have done has had the massive effect that is sometimes claimed, or are we looking at an apples and pears situation where we have a history of binge drinking in this country, shall we say, to where the French are coming from, where it was more a social... A cultural start.
Well, I repeat, they had a bigger problem than we have today at one point, and they sought to tackle it, and they tackled it, and one of the elements was the Loi Vin. But the question as to how much that contributed and how much their other measures contributed is a matter for dispute. The advertising industry and the producers would obviously say, no, it's had no effect. But actually, as part of a package, it has had an effect. I think the other thing to be clear about is I'm not proposing a total ban on sporting alcohol advertising in sporting places. I'm proposing that there should be a ban so that, for example, if the under 18 rugby players are playing a match at Murrayfield, which they will do, then the screen advertising that goes round should not have alcohol advertising it. And if there are any at my own local rugby club, if there was alcohol advertising and the under 18s were playing, then those boards should be covered up. So this is a relatively modest measure that attempts to address the situation in a modest way within the rules that we do have at the present time. It is open to the government to ban the advertising in all sporting events in Scotland, but at the moment I'm not proposing it for precisely the reason you're suggesting, because sport is also very important and I don't want to damage it. Many of my colleagues in the alcohol treatment industry and those, you know, really very serious about alcohol would say that I've been far too modest in this regard, that I should have gone for a total ban on alcohol billboards, a total ban on any promotion of any sort whatsoever, and a total ban on sporting activities. I've chosen to go for something more modest. It'll be up to the committee to decide whether that's a reasonable measure or whether it should have gone further or should not occur.
One more. I'm having a little bit of difficulty with this 200-metre thing, simply because you almost actually do agree with some of the reasons that you have well, similar doubts to myself. We have a situation at my local rugby club, which I will obviously is in my register of interests, so to speak, is that there is an off-licence co-op within 200 metres of the clubhouse. And at what point do these things overlap where you could have, say, a situation where there is over, not children's rugby being played, but adult rugby being played, but the advertising rules come in for the off-licence, which is 120 yards away, something like that.
Well, they're not allowed to, at the moment, do any promoting within 200 metres of the premises. That's not my legislation, that's already the legislation. So that's already banned from them promoting in the area. So they can't come to your rugby club and say, you know, if you don't have a license or you're not allowed to promote things, we're going to promote it here. They wouldn't be allowed to.
If it was the rugby club that did that, you know, they part of their advertising, which they don't, I have to say, but if it was a case of they had it round their park, which is within 100 or 200 metres of the shop.
If they were advertising within 200 metres of their premises, they wouldn't be allowed to do so. Mm-hmm. It's you know, because they're selling alcohol, so mm-hmm. they can't promote it mm-hmm. within 200 metres.
Yeah, I'm just as high.
It's already banned.
Yeah. Okay.
No other members? Fine. One final heading in the alcohol education policy statement. And I suppose the state question is, why have you chosen to focus on the information education elements of the Scottish Government's action rather than the alcohol strategy more generally?
I think because my original bill proposal was actually to require the government to issue a statement once in every parliament in relation to the licensing principles. And that was the two licensing principles which we have, which are unique to Scotland, which are is the question of protecting children, and the other one is public health. These are two principles. No other legislation actually has those. And originally, I wanted them to be a statement every parliament. Education is recognised by the WHO as being one of the less effective measures. It doesn't have as strong an effect as elsewhere. If we're going to spend money on education and on awareness training, etc., I believe it should be evaluated. They can be quite expensive campaigns, and we need to have them properly evaluated. And I think the Parliament, this committee, should have the opportunity of looking at that, so that once every Parliament, the government should come up with what they're planning to do and what happened in the last Parliament and give an opportunity for debate. Convener, the only times we've had debates on alcohol in this Parliament, certainly since
2003. I don't know what happened in, sorry, 2007. I don't know what happened between 2003 and 2007. But the only time we've had a debate is in relation to legislation. As far as I know, there have been no other debates. So, you know, actually providing the opportunity for this area to be looked at. And one of the concerns I have is that I'm not sure that our alcohol education in schools, for example, is particularly effective. And I think, you know, I would like that to be looked at more closely. And I think that should be done by the government giving a report. For it to be said to be bureaucratic, frankly, if they're not doing it already, the question is, why are they not doing it already? And if they're doing it already, then for them to simply table a report to Parliament and allow Parliament the opportunity of a debate, or allow this committee to have the opportunity of a debate with the Minister, I think is something that needs to be looked at.
Okay, we have no other questions for committee members. Can I thank Dr. Simpson and the Bills Unit support there. Thank you very much for your attendance and your evidence this morning.
Can I thank the committee for the time they've taken over my bill, which I realise has been significant in the heavy work programme that I do know this committee has, so thank you.
Thank you very much. We now suspend at this point, and we move into private session as previously agreed.